Okay, we're recording.
When last we met,
in
last time on Titan's Rave, Ripples of Chaos, our adventurers found a secret vault loaded with skeletons and with gold.
Looty, loot, loot!
But now they must fight their way through the Minotaur of Doom.
Is that what happens when you play a loot? Does it just go looty, loot, loot?
That's when you play the loot Pokemon, Looty.
That's a try.
Loot, 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 looty, looty.
Soon coming to
speaking
Sunday.
Of completely
just a pile of gold with eyes.
What?
That would be that Pokemon.
You know, I wouldn't be surprised if they did that. Although me and Brad were talking the other day, and we're really surprised that there is not a Badger Pokemon.
Badger, Badger, Badger.
That would make sense.
Mushroom, Mushroom.
Mushroom, Mushroom. There is a Mushroom Pokemon called Shroomish, but there's no Badger.
It's a snake. It's a snake.
Also Ekans.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, Brad.
So, Okta, sorry, just took a swipe at two of them and was partially successful. Now it's Vala's turn. Vala, you see this mess before you. What do you do?
I'm gonna cast Bane, I think. Or do you guys want me to save my spells in case we need heals? Because I'm down to two right now.
Yeah, if you have, like, cantrips or something, maybe start with those. If you have anything that'll work.
I mean, I don't.
Oh, yeah.
But you do have... You have Vicious Mockery, and you have Blade Work. Those are cantrips.
That doesn't work so well. I guess I could try that one, but...
Please mock the skeletons. Do you ever fucking eat?
Well...
Dear God, you are so skinny.
Will Mockery work on skeletons, on undead? Or is it more of that mind-affecting magic that they don't like?
Well, yeah, I did some research in this, and Vicious Mockery is something that affects intelligent creatures, so anything that has an intelligence score, basically. Whereas things like sleep and charm are only on things that have like emotions. So undead aren't affected by those, but they're affected by mockery and the like.
Yeah, I think it's in the back of the Jeep. It should be in one of those side panels.
I'm sorry, Vala, I think
it's... ...them have to have, like, a disadvantage, just so you guys know. But it affects up to three creatures of my choice, and they have to make a charisma saving throw. And whenever a target that fails a saving throw makes an attack roll or a saving throw before the spell ends, the target must roll a d4 and subtract the number rolled from the attack roll or the saving roll.
I don't know what you just said.
I mean, does that sound like it's useful? Because it would use one of my spell slots.
Is that the Vicious Mockery, or is that a different one?
No, that's Bane.
Oh. It's an anti...
Bane on the giant Minotaur is a good idea.
Yeah.
Because it means whenever they swing, they do it at a negative. Which, the less we have them hitting us, the happier we all are.
And the less you'll have to do healing.
Exactly.
Right. And I've got some healing available to at least bolster myself.
Just call it preventative healing.
And then the Vicious Mockery makes them have to, like, have a disadvantage the next one, though.
That's not bad.
Either one of those is a good use.
Yeah.
Alright, well, then maybe let's start with Bane, since, you know, Kyle has some heals, too. And then I'll just use the cantrip next time.
Just make sure you yell the spell in, like, this kind of voice.
Yeah,
you were merely born into the
Well, sort of reminder now.
I was raised in dungeon crawl.
Okay, so you can cast that on how many targets? Three?
Well, I'm gonna do the Minotaur and the two skeletons flanking him.
Okay. Alright, so the Minotaur definitely does not make his save. So he is currently baned, as it were. The skeleton to his right got a -1.
Wow.
How?
Because skeletons don't have much charisma. And the other skeleton got a 10. So, yeah, they are all currently baned. So anything, skill rolls or saving throws or attack rolls, all those have a minus d4 on their attack rolls. Okay.
And it's, that way up through the duration of the spell. It's not even the next one. It's the next
all
minute.
All of them for the next minute.
Okay.
10 rounds.
It is concentration. Fabulous. So if you do get hit, you'll have to make a check to keep it up.
Okay. And I'm also going to give Kyle some bardic inspiration. So right now, Octa and Kyle have bardic inspiration.
Mark that down.
When did I get that?
At the beginning.
Booyah!
Because you were in the doorway and she could reach you.
Hell yeah! I feel so inspired.
So do you want to move anywhere, or are you
good? I'm going to back up behind Octa.
Okay. As you step over in that direction, looking about, you also notice there's a few piles of clothes in the corner, maybe? Perhaps previous tenants of this room? I don't know, but you see those.
Previous dead people of this room?
Well, alright, Vic.
We're fighting them.
The dead ones.
Alrighty. Vic's gonna do that thing that he does.
Because
I'd already hit the one in front of me, right?
That's right, you did hit him previously.
And Doc, did you hit the same skeleton or did you hit the Minotaur earlier?
No, I hit
you hit a different one and you're standing on him now.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Or not standing on him. No, I'm back to back with Pow. He was in this space and he is now.
Oh, right. Okay. Cool. Then I'm gonna go for the dude in front of me once more.
Okay. Alright, you definitely hit and as you swing your axe. And he shatters into a pile of bones. Not as explosive as Doc did, but
I'll take it.
He's dead.
But he blew
as far as you reckon.
Then I shall do my screaming type activity and stand there.
So you're okay. Is that your turn?
Yep.
All right. Pow.
All right. I'm gonna move one over. Quarterstaff, the skeleton first.
Okay. Woo! That's unfortunate. Yeah, you swing out your staff, but unfortunately, his skeleton dexterity dodges you.
You poke it right through the hole in his ribs.
Punch him.
You go for the heart, but you just go through his ribs.
Whoops.
Damn it, pal! There is no heart.
Yeah, I'm just gonna punch him.
Okay. Yeah. Unfortunately, you're so disoriented by the sight of a gigantic skeleton Minotaur that you just can't land a hit. Unfortunately.
All right.
Which is unfortunate, really, because
full damage. Full damage wasted.
Yeah, really. Both times. I swear, you're breaking the game. All right.
It's almost like you're trying to perform like me. Really bad.
All right. Do you you still have movement, I guess? You want to move?
I'm gonna stay where I am.
Brad.
Ian said he wanted to see where he was.
I'm standing where I am. Staying where I am.
Oh, okay. I thought you said you wanted to see where you were. All right.
There we go.
Moving on. Arcus, so you are just inside the door frame. Behind these two
Which
spot? Squares.
There we go. Okay.
So these two squares represent the doorway. You just pass through. Move into the room.
Turn my guy. All right. So I step in and see all this madness going on. Guessing necrotic damage is not effective on these guys.
That's for you to find out.
Yeah.
Go ahead and try to rock the skeletons.
I'm gonna try to not do that. I will. One second. Is the skeleton Minotaur wearing metal armor?
No, he's just bone.
Just straight
for the
bone.
Big axe.
Okay, all right, never mind. He is
wearing like some rags. But that's
yeah, I will cast Ray of Frost on the Minotaur.
Oh god, right on the shoulder.
Oh,
just duck out of the way.
Hold one. if that even counts.
Guys, he has a pretty good view of the battlefield, being several feet taller than everyone, and he sees your ray coming towards him. Is that actually a spell attack? It is a ranged spell attack. You're right. So he steps out of the way.
It's not a big deal. All right, and then I still have some movement, so I'm just gonna go back to the corner where I was.
As you step in the corner, you start noticing some crunching beneath you, and you feel some battered armor crunching beneath your feet, maybe some clothes and some equipment too.
What the hell? Where are we?
Gross. That's all I got. So.
We're in the storage. Yeah.
All right. It is now the Minotaur skeleton's turn. He readies his great axe for a mighty strike against Doc, and does a 15 hit.
Does not.
Fantastic.
That's good because 19 would have.
He's gonna step back a little bit. Anybody who would like to make an attack of opportunity?
Yes.
Yep. Heck yeah.
Heck yeah.
All of us. Every single one of us will do so.
Okay, so currently, let's see. Octa, Pow, Doc, and Vic are the only ones.
Yeah.
Damn. Okay.
Like, bitch, get back here!
So as he steps back, seemingly to prepare maybe another charge attack, you all strike out against him as he steps away. Vic, you manage to slash into his legs. You manage to slash into his legs, dealing 10 more damage to him.
Is that 10 or 12?
That's just 10.
Did I get that plus 9 because of crit? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Sweet.
Pow, you swing at him, but unfortunately, you're still disoriented by this.
Monkey!
Get yourself together.
Apparently, Ian, your character currently would not want to meet your future character in Kyle's campaign. Because disorientation.
Yeah.
Kyle, or Doc, I should say, you swing at your hammer, but unfortunately...
A 12 doesn't happen to hit, does it?
Do you add one more?
I added one for my inspiration.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you thanks to Valla's inspirational powers, you just barely managed to make contact, and you do a whopping amount of damage.
You snapped his toes off.
Bonuses?
So that's 11 bludgeoning, which is probably doubled, or 1.5, or however much it is. And then I did the 1 damage for the divine favor I still have up.
That's right. So as you swing, you manage to swing high because you're pretty tall, and you knock off half of his skull.
Nice.
You did a significant blow to him. Octa, you strike forward with your impressive reach, and you do a decent amount of damage to him too, managing to slice off a few of his ribs.
I pat my glaive like, good glaive.
You should not have stepped back for that charge attack.
Well, now we know what he's doing. Come at us with your half skull, bitch.
All right, so that
I just imagine Doc. Like either one of his horns or the bottom of his jaw.
I'm going
flying.
To run up to him to try to go for another attack.
Okay.
I don't know why I closed my character sheet for that reason, but I did.
Oh damn.
Okay. Oh yeah.
That's it.
Oh yeah. Kyle, if you were here, I'd be giving you a high five.
Yeah.
How do you want to do this?
Yeah.
All right.
We've been playing for 14 minutes.
We really thought this thing was going to kill us, and all of a sudden Brad's like, no, he's dead.
And all of a sudden the Minotaur was like, I need to step back. No. Never retreat.
He's not a smart Minotaur.
No, not in the face of 4 melee beasts.
So instead of, well, it'll still be a hit. He'll take his Warhammer and he's gonna like smack him into his spine, like kind of where it's open just under his rib cage, so I can like see his spine. I want to hit it, and as I'm doing so, I'll be shouting,
"Enter Valhalla, shiny and chrome!" Wait, what?
Well, Hoffman wants your marrow.
That one's a good one. You should take Chris's.
Undead get no second chance.
If you keep suggesting things, he's going to run out of things to say. Give him a minute.
Everyone shut up.
Damn it. I should have thought of this before. Why didn't I think of this before?
Yeah, I don't know. It was pretty obvious. You were the one to kill it.
The undead are not fit for this world. Nice.
All right. So as you swing forward with your mighty yell, hitting at the base of his spine, you manage to hit a part of him that, like, is supporting his entire core. And he, like, trembles for a minute, not really falling apart. He looks like he has a skeletal grin on his face as much as skeletons can smile. And then all of a sudden, he just collapses in a pile of bones.
Yes. Hell yeah.
Right in front of you. All right.
But we still got skellies.
We do have a few more skeletons, yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. So yeah, if you want to do anything else, I'm sure you have a bonus, maybe? Movement, perhaps?
Say that again?
Movement, perhaps?
Yeah, I'll, finish my movement by coming over here to flank this skeleton and Octa.
Does flanking give a bonus in 5th edition?
I think it only gives a bonus if you have like if you're like a rogue.
There's certain feats I think that give you bonuses like that.
Yeah. All right. Octa.
I don't know. Let's check the SRD.
Octa. Excited for having seen Doc just completely murder this skeleton.
Badass.
Yeah. shouts just basically a primal kind of cry for a demon and swipes her blade across at the skelly in front of her.
Skelly.
And after all of that, is probably going to miss.
Do it.
Hey.
Yeah. Unfortunately, despite the fact that you still have stars in your eyes about what doctors did in front of you.
What does Bardic Inspiration do? Can I roll something to try to make that better?
Roll 1d6 to try to make it better.
Yeah, you would add that to your attack roll, not to your damage, unfortunately.
Oops, sorry. I was in the wrong thing and that made it go twice.
Yeah. If you were to roll it now, it would be unnecessary. So, but don't.
Oh.
Yeah,
so it won't help?
It only adds to your attack roll, but you've already successfully hit the skeleton, so it doesn't...
Oh, okay.
Right.
Yeah. So you still have stars in your eyes about what Doc did, but thankfully you still have your fighting senses about you, and you managed to deal a significant jump to the skeleton.
The way you started that, I really thought I was missing. I'm like, what the fuck does this skeleton have as his AC?
That's why you gotta wait till I finish.
Sorry.
All right. Do you have a bonus or a move?
I'm good.
Nah. All right, Valla.
Oh, okay. Let me see.
Valla, you should just swing your guitar at the skeleton, because that's that improvised weapon bludgeoning.
I've got a bar that I play that does that. He's an Elka Bong spec. He uses a summon musical instrument and has improved weapon feats or improvised weapon feats.
Nice.
So he summons up a guitar or a lute and bashes him.
I'm target that skeleton that Octa just did and see if I can hit him with a vicious mockery. And...
mock him!
Your mother was a dead hamster and your father's smelled of rotten elderberries!
Sack of bones! You're the ugliest sack of... cartilage I've ever seen.
So as you yell out this insult against him, he remembers for a moment his old life when he was once alive, and he used to be an adventurer like you before he took a minotaur to the face. And hearing your insults, he just feels such shame that he decides he can't be a skeleton anymore. He just collapses right on the spot.
Oh, jeez.
Knocked it to pieces.
Is that skeleton suicide? Is that how that works?
Skelicide.
Skelicide.
That's my vicious mockery.
All right. So, yeah, anything else you want to do, Valla?
No.
All right. Vic.
Well, seeing as how there's still a baddie right there.
Slashy, slashy.
All right, you swing your axe.
For 8 damage.
Taking a chunk out of his ribcage, but he's still not down.
Mm-hmm. Damage doesn't finish off.
And that's that.
All right. Ow.
Job's done.
Already got if I missed it.
Job's done. Zug, zug.
All the way to the other side of him. All the way around him. And just take his head off.
Just go for it.
Cartoon style, like running around everyone.
There you go.
Oh, okay. Beautiful.
And then the fail. What the fuck?
So well, here's how, in an effort to make up for all your mistakes in this battle, you go up to the wall and you like jump and you do a wall run across the wall, then you leap off and bring your quarterstaff two-handed right down into the skull of the skeleton in front of you, and he shatters into a billion bits.
Hell yeah.
And,
oh, hell yeah.
You finally let out your frustration. It's gone.
Well, run.
Hey, guys, we're alive.
I'm walking over to the pile of shiny.
Yeah, no, shoot. I'm going to the pile of shiny, like, as check soon it, as I see that skelly is dead.
Also, on my way to the pile of shiny, big old Minotaur dude, does he actually have a giant freaking axe?
He does. It's probably about twice the length of your axe. But it is there still.
Is it something I could wield with any level of effectiveness to hurt people more?
You look at it and you try to pick it up and you notice that it does have a lot of heft to it. But you as you assess it, you sort of see that maybe it's a bit too heavy to use as effectively as you can now. But if you got stronger, you might be able to swing it properly. But it's
keep
it's a bit
it
too
for
heavy.
Later.
Oh, I don't know how much stronger I could actually get. I'm damn near tapped until I get to the end of the 20 level progression pad.
Well, there's always magical items.
Yeah.
As you guys step away from the door,
I will be taking it. That's not even an argument.
The door slams shut, and the bar magically slides into place from the other side of the door. You can hear a large thunk as it clicks into its lock position.
Oh fuck!
Keep your wits about you.
Octa hears it and still digs through the pile of loot.
What are wits?
Yes, let's get all the loot.
Am I keeping wits about me? What's a wit?
Okay, so Brad, I've got divine sense. Do I sense any strong evil in the nearby area?
Well, having just had the skeletons fall before you, their evil presence is left. You don't sense anything evil, per se.
Okay.
That's everything that was in the pile. As you dig through it, you find an enormous wealth of gold and silver.
Holy
and copper.
Shit.
Holy mother of God.
You find several gems, which you could probably resell for their respective values.
Oh, a bloke.
Those of you with an appraisal.
What the hell is a zircon?
It's a type of gemstone.
Gemstone.
Oh.
What's the cloak of the mana ray?
I want to look at this cloak.
Aw, damn it. I kind of wanted that. We all were like, cloak!
You take a look at the cloak, which you can't really tell what it is. It looks like it's maybe made of some sort of scaly, slippery material on the outside, but it's just a normal cloak on the inside. It has a resemblance of, for those of you who've seen aquatic animals, it kind of looks like maybe an aquatic animal you might have seen. But it's otherwise you can't really tell what it does.
Filter of love.
Yeah, that name shouldn't be there. But you find a vial of some pink potion that if you stare at it long enough, you do see a little heart sort of appear and then puff away in smoke. And
Octa's like holding this thing, staring at it, going, "The fuck."
Bella says,
I imagine it looks like liquid bubblegum.
I know it's not fairy piss. Maybe it's fairy heart shit? There's hearts in this!
It's little fairy hearts floating in it!
So, there's blowgun needles. Is there a blowgun?
You do see a bunch of needles in, like, this pouch, but unfortunately you don't see any sort of tube in the front for
shooting. Don't play with needles you find in a pile of loot. That's how herpes happens.
Are they poisoned? Congratulations, like, you now have AIDS.
I've already gotten some stuff. I'll take the blowgun needles.
They're pointy needles.
Octa's gonna start picking up some of the gems. Because gems are shiny and I like shiny. I want that moonstone. First off, I take the moonstone.
Okay, moon.
Yes! Yeah,
amongst the pile, you also find a scroll with some unintelligible script. For those of you who can read Draconic, you do recognize it as Draconic, but you still can't read what it does.
I would if I was looking at it, but I'm a little too worried about this door right now.
Ditto.
Okay, as you look at the door, you see on it there's an inscription on the backside that you didn't notice when you came in because it's on the backside.
Mm-hmm.
That's how these things work, in case you didn't know.
Gotcha.
And the inscription looks like this.
Octa looks at everyone in the group and says, I'm just going to take this loot for now, and then we can split it up evenly once we figure out how to get out of the door.
Can we loot the little, like, rags and stuff? Is there anything in the piles of, like, bones and stuff that we might
look at the armor he was
done. So, you look around the pile of bones and equipment and stuff in the corners. You notice, strangely, that there's no bones. It's almost as if they were used for the skeletons, you might think. But otherwise, all you see is just some adventurer's packs, mostly crumbled into dust. There's not really anything useful. You find a few coins. You manage to find about 5 gold and 2 silver amongst all the belongings.
Okay, she just hands it to Valla, to Octa, and says, just hold this, we'll distribute it later too.
How much was it?
5 gold and 2 silver.
5 gold.
I'll buy the needles. So is that +1 ammunition just part of it?
The needles are the +1 ammunition.
Okay.
But you, as you pick them up, you notice there's a little bit of a magical aura about them, but you're not exactly sure what that magic might mean. You just know that they're needles and they have a bit of magic about them. You guys have one?
Is this writing Draconic?
Yeah, what is this
it's
writing?
It's anagramic.
So those of you looking at the writing, you notice that it's not, it appears to be common, but
it's common anagramic.
None of the words are recognizable.
Something spent living, something spent serving.
Looks like a name.
I have dyslexia. This is not great.
You know, able to spell it fine then.
No.
That ain't how it works, Peter. That'd be awesome, though.
Right.
Lifetime spent living, death time spent serving.
Are you saying that aloud, or are you just?
Yes.
Okay. So as you speak those words aloud, the door opens back up, the bar sliding from out of place, and the door swinging forward in front.
Brad's like, I hate you guys for figuring that out so quickly.
So quick. Jeez, dude.
Hang on, I'm still writing down this crap, because it bothers me that it's not in a list order.
So am I to believe that Octa is carrying all of this by herself?
I'm just carrying the money, the gems.
Okay, you are considered encumbered right now?
No.
because that is a lot of weight.
Yeah, I'll help carry whatever you need me to help carry.
Possibly
we dump the loot all into the cloak of the manta ray and make it into a big bag that we can tie like a hobo stick to the that big axe in the minotaur.
They don't have much of a bag to hold stuff in.
+1 ammunition, but it's
50. I'm making a giant minotaur bindle of loot.
I took the needles.
Okay, alright, I won't write that down. Did somebody take the spell scroll then?
I think we should probably maybe
the Draconian
hand that off to Arcus because I feel like he's the only one who could use it. So
okay, and the cloak of the manta ray, are we just gonna make that into a bag?
Yeah, for the moment.
so we can figure out what it is and what it does and who would be best served.
Just don't use the fishy side in.
I want to smell like fish. I can smell like fish.
Well, we make sure no one steals our gold if it all smells like fish.
This is true. We're not going to go digging in the bag of fish.
Guys, can
and
I
then
I'll
and then we have some goldfish going.
Leave me alone.
Guys, no one ever asserted that this smells like fish, but if it does, we will let Valla wear it whenever that little officer dude comes around, just so he's like, dude, what the hell? Why?
Maybe we can use the fishy smell to our advantage with the chunks of fish left on the split Saurians.
Yeah.
This is
although,
Valla,
you could probably just smell like that if we did go to that the
fish weaponry store?
Ship bucket.
Bucket, yeah.
On the wharf, we would probably smell like fish after a night there.
Yeah, probably.
Fish and stale ale.
Or like every London pub ever.
Yeah. 5, 10,
15. Sounds like a good time. We didn't die.
We have 900 technically if you count up the value of the gems. We have 950 gold pieces.
Nice.
How much?
Just within the gems, right?
No, in the gems alone, we have 550, and then we have a pile of 400 as well, and then we have 500 silver pieces and 2,600 copper.
Isn't 2,600 copper?
Huh?
260 silver.
260
so
silver.
26 gold worth.
26. And then 5. So
it's 50 gold.
We have 476 gold and gold pieces. Gold, copper, silver, value-wise.
Okay. Probably be easiest to keep it separate in general, though, because we're going to be separating those gold, those copper pieces between all of us.
Yeah.
So, instead of thinking of their value,
do you want to just do that now, real quick, or?
I mean, I don't mind. We can.
Open the door, so right the door.
Might as well do it now, so we're not nobody's encumbered and all that.
All right. Well, that's 650 copper pieces each. Oh wait, I did that wrong. My bad. Sorry. No, ignore me.
Ignore me!
Okay, that's approximately 433 copper pieces per.
Yeah, 84 per person for silver.
84?
Yeah, it's 83.3, so.
How much for the copper pieces again?
I'll take 83, yeah.
How much was the copper?
433 per person. So it's 433.3 again.
Okay, I'm just going to take 433.
And then 66 gold per person.
Okay, you could buy a horse.
Finally! I don't know, man. If I'm going to buy a mount, I might go buy myself. What were we talking about the other day? A giant fire-breathing dog.
Yeah.
Name it Arcanine and be cool like that. You guys said 66 gold per?
Yeah, 66 gold.
All right.
And then all of those gems.
Yeah, and then I've got the scroll.
Caucasian?
Somebody else has the...
I apologize. Can someone tell me the silver one more time?
How big are those gems?
83.
83 silver per?
Yeah.
They're not terribly big. You could probably fit them in
all right, so total, the gems, actual, like, physical gemstones, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. We have 10.
11.
11. Sorry, I forgot the zircon.
We'll want to take that to get them appraised. Well, maybe not appraised, but find somebody to buy them off us.
Why don't we each take 2...
I'll take jasper and onyx.
I'll take the star zircon. Rose quartz and
I'll take the zircon. Everyone else can get 2.
So Pow has the zircon. You said the star rose quartz.
Yeah.
And what?
The cryosophrase.
Okay.
I'll take the onyx.
I've got onyx and jasper.
You've got the onyx?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is there anything left? What's left?
The moonstone, 3 quartz, and 2 sardonyx.
I'll take the quartz.
Okay.
No, it's 2 star rose.
Oh, is it? My bad.
It's one sardonyx. I'll take the three quarts.
Okay.
I'll take whatever's left.
I know, Octa, you said you wanted the moonstone.
I'm keeping the moonstone. So that leaves you then, Kyle, with one of the Star Rose quartz and the sardonyx.
Okay. I can do with it.
Unless Valla took three gems.
No, I didn't.
Okay. All right. I have it written down, so we should be all right.
Yeah, I got my okay. Written down.
Yep, I'm good.
Yep, stuff's down.
The door's open, right?
Door's open.
Yeah. So you go out the door. You see the same sight before you, some crates and barrels, mostly dry and empty. A few scraps of food, maybe drink there, but nothing really good for you. It's been so long. Upstairs, Arcus and Pau, you remember, you couldn't really find anything. It seems to be pretty black up there. Not terribly safe, perhaps. It's a pretty weak floor. And you also remember that the floor in the main hallway is a little bit weak. So as you go upstairs, you remember to circumvent that. Are you going to leave, or does the rest of you want to take a look upstairs? What do you mean?
I forget what was going on upstairs whenever we...
Upstairs, there was a bedroom. There was a hallway and maybe one or two bedrooms. And there was like a... I guess like an outline on the wall in the hallway of where like an old shield or family crest used to be. But other than that, there's nothing up there.
Yeah, nothing interesting.
Is there anything else on the first floor that we haven't checked out?
The first floor, as you go up, you notice it's pretty much empty. The floor is pretty clear. There's some grass poking up through the floorboards near the edges, and there's dirt and soot everywhere. But all the furniture seems to have either been taken or are smashed to bits, and there's really nothing of value in the vicinity.
Right. All right, then I guess we're good to go.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, agreed. I'm ready to get working towards our destination.
All right, so you guys make your way out. You leave the house, and you find your way. You find the right direction to go towards the east. Those of you who know how to track by the sun, you realize that's the direction to go. At this point, it's probably about 1 or 2 in the afternoon. So you can continue walking for a short while, and after a while, you make it into what looks like the edges of a where the forest. Starts forming along the sides of the path.
Okay, well, before we do that, this whole time I have been looking for herbs.
Okay, so as you're walking?
Yeah.
I didn't find anything.
Valla found dirt.
Dirt.
What's it's this magical thing? That's grass. You found grass.
What is that? Herbalism.
It's in the drive.
Yeah, I was looking there. Okay, relax. All right, whatever. Okay, so go ahead and roll a 2d6, Kirsten.
So when does my... that's just whenever I'm implementing stuff, huh? Whenever my herbalism roll actually comes into play. Aw, shit.
You want to use that bardic inspiration?
That's okay. I mean, I technically found something. Whether it's a good thing or a bad thing, we shall see.
Yeah, unfortunately, your inspiration is faded by now. So
oh, well, then there you go. I can't even do that.
Yeah.
I'm so useless!
Alright, so... you find... you find Wisp's Breath.
Wisp's Breath.
Yes. Which you know, with your herbalism skill, it slows intoxication.
Awesome! I'm gonna get more drunk! I wish I had found this before the drinking contest. That technically is cheating, but still.
I suppose so. On the way, I'm gonna try... Forget that I had a really bad drink made and, like, start sipping it. Realize it's absolutely horrible and actually poisonous, basically.
Mm-hmm.
What does that do to me?
So yeah, you drink a bit of it, and you taste the alcohol, but it's terribly bitter, and as you even ingest a little bit of it, you notice it's very you know, has a very poor taste to it, even so much as to might make you sick. So you stop drinking it, or are you going to continue?
I stop drinking and pour the rest of it out. I'm done. Yeah,
so, nope. So you spit it out. You get rid of that. None of the effects. It doesn't really negatively affect you since you didn't fully drink it, but it's you can tell it wasn't one of your better brews.
Okay.
All right. So you guys are it's just about nighttime when you reach the edge of these forests. You're still on the road, but there's trees starting to form on either side of you.
How many more days do we have? Travel.
What's that?
How many more days travel do we have?
How many more days travel?
It's been about,
I think that was the end of our
third or fourth.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. No, that's too many. Five, six.
Because we had nothing happen.
Yeah, it's about the end of your sixth day.
Okay.
So we're almost there.
Damn, we should have rented those horses.
We would have been broke.
Well,
not anymore.
We can afford it, but we didn't know we would be able to afford it.
I still
it.
Don't have as much as I'd like to.
Yeah.
All right, so it's nighttime. You guys set up camp, right?
Yep.
Yeah. Camp on the edge of the forest.
I sleep in a tree.
I'm going to spend the night brewing another batch.
We have tents.
Filling my wine skin again.
All right, go
she
for it.
She likes trees.
Plus, did you see what happened last time?
Yes, now she can drop on the orcs from above.
Exactly, or I can shoot them from, you know, from a tree.
From a tree. 14. Yeah, so you brew, you feel like a pretty proud of, a pretty decent drink. It looks like it has a good clarity to it.
Sweet.
All right. So, Valla, how are you going to sleep in a tree?
I mean, I'm going to snuggle up on a branch next to the trunk.
Uh-huh.
In my blanket.
And that's it.
Just like Faith lapped against it.
Okay.
You just see me like with my arms hanging off of it on a branch.
Make a disadvantaged dexterity check.
Oh well, she's asleep.
Yeah.
Uh oh.
Goodbye, tree.
Yeah. About halfway through the night, you fall out of the tree. And you suffer 1 point of damage.
But you remain asleep.
she has to make a constitution or concentration check.
Yeah.
Is she concentrated on sleeping? Yes.
If you're committed to sleeping, then go ahead and make a constitution check. Yeah, you wake up immediately.
Thanks.
And as you look around, you hear some noises in the trees, perhaps some rustling. You see some dark shapes moving off in the distance, well beyond the range of your vision, but you can still see the shade of them from the moon through the trees.
What do you see with your elven eyes? My brand!
My brand!
Well, she's probably immediately going to scream, "Guys, wake up!"
Oh, man.
So, everyone, you hear Valla yell, screaming for you to wake up. Valla, you notice that those shadows in the trees immediately disappear. They start, you know, you hear rustling even more, and they're just gone. Everyone, you're all woken up. You get out of your tents.
I jump out of bed and go, "What's wrong? What's wrong?"
Yeah. Octo was sleeping between the tents and like jumps up, holding her glaive out, like the. What was that?
Worse than the staff. Oh my gosh, that was a real wake up call.
She says, "Listen, I fell out of a tree, and when I got up, there were things in the trees, and there was things circling the camp, and then they disappeared once I yelled."
Nah, I'm gonna fall back.
Glad they're gone.
I'm falling back asleep.
Octa just kind of nods at Val and said, "We're good," and then plops back over.
Val cautiously goes and sleeps very near Octa.
I'm like more in the center of camp this time.
What's well, that? That's where I was last time. I took a javelin to the chest.
Better than to the knee.
Being a watch.
You're actually going to stay and watch awake?
No, I'm not going to stand. I'm going to wake up and watch, but I'm going to watch.
Okay, gotcha. All right, so...
Pal's version of watching, which is sleeping with his staff.
You guys sleep through the rest of the night with no issues. Nothing comes to bother you. No shadows in the night, unfortunately. And you wake back up, you feel refreshed. Any spells you had missing, you get the slots back for. Any skills you've used.
Welcome back, Action Surge.
Hello, key point.
Your key points, yes. Those are returned as well.
Yay. Oh.
All right. So you reckon you have about a day's journey left, for those of you who are familiar with the map and landscape.
Brad, I know that's your dice. I'm afraid.
I'm just playing with them as I talk. So as you walk through the woods, following the road the entire time, you get to a certain point where you maybe notice something a bit off about the road. Everyone make a... Actually, I'll just do your passive perception.
That's not really good how that works, Thea. By the way, I just realized that all of my Warhammer attacks, I've completely forgotten to add my strength to the attack roll.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, welcome to the party. It's not a good realization, is it?
No.
Because what's your strength on, Doc?
My strength's a 3.
Yeah, it's your strength mod, I'm hoping, is a 3.
Yes, that's what I mean.
If the strength is 3, you wouldn't be able to walk with that armor on.
Exactly. Yeah, that was kind of the same point that I ran into when I realized my great axe was not including my strength. I was like, oh, that's good. That's a +4 on every swing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, I'm like, why does +2 seem off? I don't understand.
So, Pow and Doc, you guys have a bit above average perception for most people. So you notice on the ground as you're walking, there's some wheel treads, maybe some footsteps, maybe driven harder ground than they would have been normally. And also some larger steps, maybe the steps of plated boots or something, as best you can tell.
Huh.
I at least take the time to stop and point it out to everybody and say, hey guys, everybody, take a look at this.
Seems a well-trafficked road.
Yes.
Must be getting close to Vorakis.
Seems like a struggle.
Or that.
I agree with how something's not right. Could the cart been heavier than normal?
It looks like drag marks to me, too.
We should follow them.
Can we
along the road, or
I was gonna say, is this like following the road like normal, or is this like taking off into the forest?
So you see, for the most part, the marks seem to lie parallel to the road, as if they were just, you know, particularly deep cuts by a tire or something like that, or the footsteps. And at certain points, you do notice that the wheels seem to turn into the forest to the north, but you can't identify the trail after they get into the grassy area past the road. They just seem to turn towards the north, and there's no deep ruts or anything inside the woods, but there are tracks sort of gently leading in that direction.
Hmm.
Interesting.
Say we should all head in that direction? This seems to be what we're looking for.
Well, I think we should make it to Vorakis first.
I agree.
If we can't track it through the woods, but we can set up some sort of, you know, fake thing, maybe that's the direction they'll take us.
Okay.
Yeah, make them kidnap us.
Yeah.
Yes.
Make them lead us there, because I don't think we'll be able to track it through the woods.
Okay.
Yeah, none of us are too familiar with these woods, nonetheless too familiar with being in the woods.
Okay.
It sounds fun. Let's have like two people in the front of the caravan, and like everyone else hides inside the caravan, and then they take it, and we're like, "Fuck you!" Like the Trojan horse of caravan.
I think we put Pow and Valla out in front, and let them grab a hold of it, only to realize there's the barbarian, the two dragonborn, and Octa bristling with weapons.
Say hello to my demon friend!
By a monkey man.
You have two large draconians, you have a very small...
Yeah, but they're common face.
And a large barbarian just hanging out.
Big floral gardening.
I'm commonplace looking. Everyone else is pretty commonplace.
Yeah, he's a weird thing.
Which is why they would want to stop and take charge of that particular caravan. And while we may look normal,
more interesting.
Whirlwind of doom coming out of that with holy light and roars and dragon's breaths. And
we can disguise him too and make him look less intimidating.
Well, mainly it makes sense for the two of you because you carry the fewest weapons other than your quarterstaff.
You look the least imposing as far as weaponry is concerned.
I've got less
of a threat in that phase.
Two swords, darts, and a giant glaive. I think stands out. Back to Vorakis. We're
discussing all these plans. I assume you're going to continue walking down the road?
Yes. I'm going to continue to Vorakis.
So you keep walking down the road, and as the sun seems to begin to descend toward the horizon, you approach Vorakis. You can see before you a pretty large city. There's a large branch of the road heads off to one side, apparently going into what you believe to be the caravan palace that you were told about. You see the river fork right through the city and pass through the center of it. And behind it, Pau, you notice this most of all, you see a very large mountain standing apart from the rest of the mountain range to your left, so to speak. You see a very large mountain off in the distance that towers above all the other mountains nearby.
I have the urge to climb that mountain.
Let's save that for another day, dear friend.
I'll come with you, though.
Okay. To the caravan palace, then?
To the caravan palace.
They better be playing electro swing music.
We gotta go find Jim Crick.
Jim Crick?
Oh, yay, notes!
So as you approach the city, you notice there's a wall around it, a loose guard at the gate, but nobody's really stopping you. People are entering and exiting freely. And you can see where the road branches off towards the caravan palace, so you make your way along that road around the city. And as you come in, it's getting about nighttime, but you notice that the area is bustling. There's several globes of what appears to be maybe magical light lighting up the ceiling. There's some braziers around the walls, and all the carts and carriages that are being loaded and unloaded have some torches on them and lanterns and the like. But there's a myriad of carts and wagons and horses and what looks like a dock for land. Like there's piers upon which things are loaded, and there's several warehouses nearby, and there's just a whole cacophony of work and noise going on, even at this late hour.
It's gonna storm here. Sorry. I mean, in real world.
No.
It's been raining here all day.
Oh, yeah, all day.
I am super pumped. I love... Oh, lightning! Yeah! Woo!
From where we are, can we see anybody that looks, like, in charge? Or is there, like, a main building that we can go into?
You do notice off to the side, there is a, what appears to be an office situated against the wall of the palace, as you can see it. It seems like a place that a few people are entering and out of pretty frequently. So you judge it to maybe be the headquarters or the main location, the main office. So I'm guessing you make your way over there?
Yep, head in that direction.
All right. You approach and you see, again, as before you, there's a lot of people entering and exiting. Apparently on business, they'll have sheets of papers and their noses are down looking at what their business is. I'm not really paying attention to their surroundings.
I'll walk. Is the door to the building open, closed?
It's constantly opening and closing. It's one of those doors that has a double hinge, so it swings back and forth because it has so much traffic. But it's free for you to go inside.
Go ahead and walk inside.
All right. Just Arcus?
Let's go talk to Sabibu. I'll go.
Right, so Doc will wait in the not lobby, but we'll be walking around the rest of the palace.
Okay. So the 2A team members, you guys go inside.
A.
And,
Should I say A?
You go inside and you notice there's a lot of hustle and bustle, a lot of people moving around. There appears to be some, there's a clerk's desk right in front and some desks beyond in the room beyond the desk. People, you know, looking through papers, scheduling ports, that kind of thing, you know, as you might expect a warehouse shipping receiving facility to deal with. Mm-hmm. So there's someone currently at the desk. They're talking to someone right now.
I guess I'll wait till that person is done and then approach the front desk.
That's very polite of you. So as you wait there...
This whole time, Octa's kind of just, like, looking around, like, what the... This place is busy. She's not even, like, paying attention. She's just following Argus.
you wait some more, probably for another hour, perhaps.
Oh, wow.
Jesus.
Do you want to do anything at this point?
Octa holds her hand out to Argus with, like, you know, like this. Like, we're going to play rock, paper, scissors the whole time.
I'll play one round with you. Ready? Ready?
Yeah. Right.
1, 2, 3, go!
Ah! I can't even keep this in frame. Okay, hold on. We gotta count out loud.
One, two, three, go!
We're off. Oh, you won.
Woo! Alright. So as you're doing this, the clerk looks over his current engagement shoulder, and he sees you guys playing him. He's, one second, sir. One second. I'll be with you in just a moment. And he puts his head back down and continues talking with the person in front of him.
Octa starts whistling a tune, much like the Jeopardy theme song would sound like. Just obviously not exactly the same thing, because Jeopardy doesn't exist yet.
Yeah, but it will.
So you guys wait a bit longer. In the meantime, everyone outside, Doc, you're walking around, and you look at all the loading and receiving that's going on. You notice some things of interest to you, maybe some crates full of armor, some bindings put together of that. You see,
if he sees the chance, he wants to just give a hand, just strength wise, just lifting some boxes, getting stuff into caravans, just trying to help them move along. Just, you know, one or two quick boxes here and there.
So how are you going to approach that?
Samaritan priest that he is.
How are you going to approach that? Like, are you just going to walk up and start lifting boxes?
Just like if I see a group of people that are grabbing boxes from a certain pile and moving them over to a caravan, I would just go up.
I'm gonna arrest you for trying to steal stuff.
Yeah, I just thought of that. I'm trying to. Doc would think
you have the notion to do it, and
Doc
then you
would,
think about it. Don't want to do it anymore for fear that might be misconstrued.
No, it's not. It's Doc would just want to help, so he would just start helping without thinking of asking, because he doesn't need to be asked, or he doesn't feel he, you know, he just thinks he can, so he should.
I understand. So you walk up and you lift one of these crates, and one of the guys who just dropped off a crate turns around and looks at you like, hey, what are you doing?
Do you need a hand? Looks like you guys could use a hand. I was going to help out.
You're not stealing our hours, all right? Who sent you? Was it the other union?
No. And I put the box down and say, sorry, I was just trying to help.
Yeah, we don't need your help, all right? We're trying to make a buck here.
Alrighty. My apologies. Go on. Enjoy your work. And then walk away.
He gives you a rude gesture as you leave.
Valla, seeing this happen, gives him back the same rude gesture.
And then he looks over, he sees, like, beyond Doc, he sees you do that, and then he gives you the same rude gesture, because he feels like maybe that wasn't enough for you guys.
And she like, bows up to him and gives him an even bigger, exaggerated rude gesture.
He's gonna get you out of this place.
I go, no, I probably don't even see this. I'm gonna not do anything, assuming I don't see it.
You do see Valla pass by you from the direction you just came from.
Okay.
You guys just walk past each other like you're just wandering around out here.
Okay, Valla. So the guy at this point punches you. And unfortunately,
hearing that, I will turn around and turn around.
He hits you for one damage. And yeah, he hits you.
Yeah.
Valla looks incredulous at him and says, "Is it really your freaking prerogative to go around being mad at people that was just trying to help you?"
I go and I go to grab Valla.
A woman?
Close. Try to put my
what
hand over
of
her
a
mouth.
And are you?
Say, are you? I'm sorry.
Are you saying
her,
women can't be hit?
Oh, Brad, you're gonna take that.
A woman. Obviously, I can be hit, sir. That doesn't mean that you should do it just because you can't control your own behavior.
Well, if I can't control my behavior, why can't you?
I can control my behavior just fine, sir.
Well, are you sure?
Drag her away. Drag her away now.
I'd like to go and drag her away.
Okay. Baller, are you resisting?
She flips him off on her way being dragged away.
I'm gonna wave at him as we leave.
You're with me.
Am I? I thought I.
Yes.
I
thought you said you were with them.
I just thought it was just those two.
Whoever you're with.
I thought you were with us.
I thought do what I originally said. Yeah.
Okay.
So are we? Is it our turn in line yet?
Yeah. So it's been about 2 hours at this point.
Dear God, what are we at the DMV?
And finally, the person in front of you, the only person who was in front of you the entire time, nobody else is lined up behind you. He takes his leave, you know, waves goodbye to the guy at the clerk desk and finds his way out the door. And you walk up to the counter. The guy's like, yeah, hey, why didn't you just come up?
I thought you had business with this other gentleman. I was being polite.
Oh, well, yeah, I mean, that's nice and everything, but we move too fast around here to be polite. You just gotta get your business done. What do you need?
All right. Well, I was sent here by, wait, I know his name. Frecken? Is that his name?
Frecken? Yeah.
Yeah, Frecken.
He says he gets his potion materials Glass. Through this port, and his last couple caravans have been disappearing before they reach him.
Yeah, we've had that problem.
Yeah, so we were sent here to investigate and possibly try and help out in whatever way we can.
Yeah, I mean, we got people helping a little bit, but maybe you can too. I don't know. You want to talk to Jim Crick?
Yeah, that would be great.
Yeah, he's kind of charging around here. All right, let me go get him. One sec. He makes his way into the back. and you wait for a little bit.
Oxy shouts, "Be quick about it!"
More waiting.
Wonderful. Yeah, all right. And because of your... make a persuasion check, actually. See how much that affects him.
Crit fail. He goes as slow as he can.
It's not terrible.
So his steps quicken a little bit, but not as much as you might have hoped for. About 20 minutes later, he comes back out with another guy. A kind of spindly gentleman with a long pointed beard, but no mustache.
How is he playing with his tail?
Pal's just playing with his tail in the corner, waiting for something to happen.
Yeah, no, Octa's at this point so tired of just standing still that she's actually pulled her glaive out, and she has it kind of like sitting in front of her, and she's leaning on it like this.
All right, Octa's Gandalfing in the corner.
Yep.
No,
I'm standing right next to Arcus, but I'm just, you know, I'm Gandalfing while I'm doing it.
Gandalfing, yeah. And so this guy comes up, be like, "Hey, yeah, what can I do for you?"
How you doing? My name is Arcus. This is Octa and Pow.
Uh-huh. Hey.
We were sent here by Freckend. Do we know his first
Arcus.
Name?
Yeah, Arcus. Yeah. He's off in the store, right? Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. You here to help?
We're here to help try and figure out these caravan disappearances.
Everyone wants to figure that out. I can't really offer any reward or anything. Maybe Freckend can. I just need to get business done. But if you can find him, you know, maybe we can give you a discount in the future or something, if that's okay.
Yeah, that sounds good to us.
All right, cool. Yeah, all right. So here's what we're thinking. Nobody really wants to do this because they're afraid of getting taken too, but we think this is a pretty good idea. So we have like a dummy caravan we got set up, you know? We got a few guards we can throw in there too. You know,
at this point, Octa's like, hell yeah!
Sir, say no more. Dude. That's exactly what we were thinking.
Oh, all right, yeah. So we're gonna drive it out there and see if it gets taken. Usually, it happens like every 7 days. That's when we've seen things happen. Every 7 days, you know, that stuff happens. You know, if we send anything between, like, you know, 3 days away, 4 days, whatever, it doesn't get taken. It just passes right through, no problem. So the 7 day problem is the one we're trying to fix. So we're gonna send the caravan out. You guys are gonna load it into it. And if you get kidnapped, whatever, I don't care. I'm not paying anyways. but if you manage to find out who's taking them and beat them down, whatever, you do what you want. I'm not sure how tough you are, but yeah, you do that. Okay, cool.
We'll take care of it.
All right. So yeah, that's gonna leave tomorrow night.
Tomorrow night.
Yeah.
Tomorrow night. I'm good.
All right. Where should we meet you?
Just come back here.
All right.
Yeah. Just ask for Jim Crick.
And I look at the other dude. I'm like, we will not wait 2 hours to talk to somebody.
Yeah, next time we know.
Yeah, why would you wait? Nobody waits for you.
We're new to the area.
Yeah, I bet you are. All right. Kyle, he looks over and sees you in the corner. And he gives you sort of a weird look. He's like, I haven't seen your kind of line around here before. What are you?
Venarin.
Yeah, where do you come from?
It's way north.
Oh, cool. You guys need any supplies or anything? We're looking for new venues.
Nope.
No? All right. Well, I've seen some of your kind around here before. Maybe
really?
I'll see them in town or something.
Where?
Oh, yeah, they usually they hit the pubs a lot, and then they go up to Moon Perch, that big old mountain behind us.
Moon Perch.
Thanks.
Yeah. So mostly cool guys.
I don't know about you guys, but that sounds familiar.
Geography, Kyle, it doesn't change.
Sorry, I couldn't help
it. It's purpose
exactly.
Changed,
the North remembers.
It does not.
Yep. All right, so I'll see you guys tomorrow.
What do we do there, Kyle?
So you can say that to me again.
Moon Perch. That's where Tim was.
Oh, that's right. All right. So I will bid Jim farewell and we'll see him tomorrow.
Yeah. See you later. And he just walks away. He doesn't even like shake your hands or anything. He just goes back to his office.
So Octa goes like this to him, and then walks away.
How very anime of you.
Yep.
All right. Vic, what have you been doing this whole time? What are you up to?
I've just been kind of hanging around, watching people, seeing if anyone decides to do something that would make me hit them with an axe.
Okay.
I've got no lumber for trade, and there's so many supplies that the typical course of actions that we go through to set up new lumber trade routes anyway. I don't have any of the stuff I would need to do that, so I'm basically here just looking for trouble, if trouble decides to present itself.
Yeah, as you're waiting, one second, you know, I'll repeat it for you. So as you're waiting, you sort of gaze across all the business going on. You see people loading and unloading, nothing really illicit going on. But, you know, amongst the crowd of people going about their business, you do notice a bit of a smaller individual, seemingly, you know, maybe brushing up against a few folks. You don't really notice any alarm on those folks' parts, but you do. Go ahead and make a perception check.
A little pocket thief.
Maybe, if you can see it.
Possibly.
Cut purse.
I think he saw it.
He might have.
Yeah. So as you're watching him, you see him brush up against a guy, and his hand comes away with something, which he quickly tucks away. And you also notice that he looks like the size of a child. He looks like the size of a child, but he has more adult features, perhaps a gnome, if you've ever seen one.
It's Worven.
He's not a thief.
How far away is he?
From you right now, he's about 50, 60 feet. He's sort of making his way through the crowd. He's coming in your direction generally, but it looks like he's sort of heading towards the one exit that's closest to that building you're nearby.
I will, when I see him, I'm going to take and do as much discrete reallocation of funds on my person as possible, and get a take one of my little belt pouches and put, you know, 4 or 5 copper pieces in it, and just kind of hang it to where it's slightly visible. Okay. Make sure my cloak is tucked up over the handle of the great axes and whatnot, and just kind of make myself look like a guy standing there wanting his money to be taken.
Okay.
And hopefully try to snag this kid when he decides to Oliver Twist me.
All right. So you're standing there, sort of in the vicinity of the general crowd, looking like as much as you can, like just a tourist, with no handle on how pickpocketing works. And you see this kid approach you. He looks pretty nonchalant. He's looking around, trying to, you know, look like he's not focused on anything. And he takes a wide route, which you see out of the corner of your eye, and he approaches you from your side and, you know, nudges up against you, you know, saying, "Oh, sorry, sir." Are you going to try to catch him?
Do I feel any tug or anything on any of my areas where money might be?
Yeah, you actually feel a tug more on where you left most of your gold.
Okay.
You feel a severe lightning all of a sudden.
I will go ahead and grab him by the scruff of his neck.
All right. Go ahead and make a dexterity check.
Oh, Lord. Now, as an option, given that we're here, I don't know if this would have any play or anything into this. Barbarians have danger sense at level 2. It's an advantage on dex saving throws against effects you can see, like traps and spells. Would that be similar to an advantage on this as well?
Okay.
Given that it's making a dexterous attempt to prevent an action? I don't know if that would or not.
That would apply. Because you're sort of aware of the situation, so you can perceive it as a...
All right, then I'll just make a second dexterity roll for one with advantage.
Go for it.
Yeah, not that it mattered, but there you go.
So you reach forward, and you manage to get your hand pretty firmly around the back of his collar. He unfortunately wasn't expecting anyone to notice him, so he's caught by surprise, really. You're holding him there. He's like, oh, sorry, let me go. Yeah, I gotta go. I gotta get to my family.
And as he does that with my free hand, I'm gonna pull a hand axe out and put it up against his throat and get right down in his ear. Go, boy, you're not a good pickpocket. You're obvious to anyone looking. Now here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna go have a discussion with the law, and I'm gonna look around for anyone that looks like they may want a pickpocket. Like I'm sure at a port there's going to be customs officers or things of that nature overseeing onloading, offloading, things like that.
Mm-hmm. You do notice a few guards about, mostly near the entrances, just sort of watching the comings and goings. So there's a couple just by the door there. The kid is trembling in your arms, in your hands. He's like, "I'm sorry, sir. I didn't take anything. I swear."
I'm just going to walk right over to one of the guards. If need be, I'll pick him up by his neck and carry him over. Then I'm going to go over to one of the customs officials and ask what they do with pickpockets in their fine port city.
They see you approaching, dangling this kid by your hand. Like, what seems to be the problem, sir?
Hey.
Lad lightened my belt by a bit. Watched him in the crowd. Saw him lighten several other people's belts. Figure I want my property back, and you might want to get the hooligan away from good paying customers.
Ah, right you are, sir. Do you know how much?
I'll hold the kid out. Well, haven't had a chance to check yet. Grabbed him as he was trying to take it, so I'd really like to appreciate his wares. I've got pretty good idea of how much money I had on me. If we have an office where
it's not your food.
Be sure to come into to balances with what I had.
He leads you over. There's just down the street, actually, there's a guard station.
No.
And they walk you down there, lead you in. There's a meeting room, interrogation chamber, perhaps. They set you down. They tie the kid to the table, and they empty his pockets. There's piles and piles of gems and gold and maybe a few pieces of paper, sort of littered on the table. You do notice when you inspect your own amounts that you're missing about 50 gold from one of your pouches.
Damn.
What about the two gemstones that we pulled out of the Minotaur's area? Are those still on me, or?
Yeah, those are still on your person. Okay.
I'll let him know that I'm about 50 gold short. That's about all I'm short at the moment. Not sure how many other marks he took to accumulate the rest of this. I'll leave it up to y'all what you'll do with that.
Aye, sir. We'll probably make him talk however we can. You're welcome to take another 10 gold out of the pile if you like, for as a reward, if you like.
I appreciate that. I'll take 10 gold and hand the officer 2 for being helpful.
Here's a tip.
Basically.
What?
He's tipping. Thank you, sir. And then you're tipping him.
He's probably going to tip himself with the rest of it. I'm just saying. There's no way to know what people got.
I'm okay with that. I work for a lumber trading family. That's where I come from. You tip the people that help. You make sure that they don't steal more of your wares.
It's not like he's actually going to be able to find everybody that they got stolen from anybody. Anyway.
Well, of course not.
So.
Exactly. Of course not.
So yeah, as you walk out, you can hear the guard talking to the kid. All right, now we're going to find out who the rest of the people you took from are. Maybe in a little bit of a menacing voice, but you react anyway to that.
Nope.
All right. So you walk on out. By this point, Arcus and Valla and Pau, you guys walk out. Or not Valla, I'm sorry. Okta. You guys walk out, and you're looking around. You see Doc and Valla coming away from an interaction with maybe one of the workers. And you can't see Vic anywhere. Maybe
Midna.
He's around here somewhere. You don't know.
I know it's bacon. Leave it alone.
Did you guys see where Vic wandered off to?
I did not. I've been, I've had my hands full.
Octa, like, looks at Valla and goes,
"Don't look at me. It's his fault."
I agree, but still.
I'm sure you're both at fault here, but you know.
So, what's the plan?
Tomorrow night, we're going to come back, and they have a dummy wagon set up for us, and we're going to take
I will
out.
Say that I did not hit anyone, okay?
I'm proud of you. I'm very proud of you for holding back. I appreciate that.
Octa's like, damn it, Valla, why not?
You were the one that stopped me before.
Yeah, you stopped me from bashing, but granted, that was my guitar, and that isn't important.
That's why. Your fists? Go ahead, swing away. But don't hit anybody with the guitar. The guitars are expensive.
Tomorrow night, right?
What's that?
Tomorrow night or tomorrow morning?
Tomorrow night.
Tomorrow night.
Tomorrow night. Got it. Do we have a day and a half? Half a day?
You guys
actually, it's already nighttime for you guys. Right?
Oh.
It's already, at this point, it's probably like 8, 9 o'clock.
Yeah, it's, you feel the night coming along for the night.
I want to hit a bar.
We'll go to a tavern to stay in for the night.
Yeah, I know of a tavern, but you'll have to watch your purses.
Those are the best kind.
All right, well,
I disagree, but
I'm
going
to the tavern brawl, so.
So you find your way, Valla leading them all the way to the gleaners, which you're familiar with.
Baby! Vic has Chris has his baby.
Oh.
I have my baby.
Who's this?
He's ready to smash already.
So yeah, you find your way over to the gleaners. It's all the way across town from where you are. Closer in the direction of Moon Perch, Pal, you notice. You get ever closer to the looming mountain.
On our way there, Okta puts all of her gold pouches like down the front of her breastplate so that it's between her boobs. So she's like, ain't no one getting there without me knowing.
Okay.
Bella's already tucked turns away and there
say am I back at this point and have told you guys about the philandering little children in the town?
Yeah, I would have assumed, I was gonna say we would hang out until Vic got back.
Well, yeah, we're not just leaving.
Okay. Yeah. You guys have
when I get back, I'll let them know what transpired. And
at that point, Okta shoves all her money like, between her boobs.
Caught the little kid.
The moment she got
around with the money,
doing that to herself.
Good work, sir.
Just gonna stuff it all in the crotch. I don't have much.
Okay, so a seemingly well-endowed Veneran, a seemingly
oh god,
uniboob, tiefling.
It's a breastplate. It's made of metal. It's not going to change.
Yes, but you're pushing out the center of it with all the gold you stuff into it.
Uniboob.
You have a lot of gold right now.
Uniboob.
I have 154 total, which is not that much.
That's a lot.
You mean like all your coins add up to 154?
Yeah.
Or just 154 gold coins?
No, that's all my coins are added up to gold pieces.
Exactly. You have a lot of copper and silver pushing out that your uniboob, too.
All right, then I just put my gold pieces between my boobs.
All right. So you're like the lady from Total Recall.
All the best stuff is in my boobs.
So you make your way across town. You get to the Gleaners. As you approach, you hear some yelling and shouting. As you start to open the door, a guy gets thrown through the window. And you hear raucous cheers from the inside, you know.
Okta's like, I like this place already.
There's Valla music playing.
A big whiff and says, it feels good to be home.
As you come inside, Valla, you know, you recognize the two folks on stage. There's a drummer and a flautist playing a jaunty tune. Everyone else is having a good time. There's a couple of brawls going on drunkenly, nothing very effective. That one guy got tossed out and was apparently the only one who could actually fight. There's, you know, people drinking, carrying on, a few people just talking noisily, and, you know, it's everyone's having a good time with it.
I'm going to chug my drink that I made yesterday.
All right.
Take the thing I made. And then shout out, who just tossed that guy out a window?
Boy, that's me! Do you like my
window? And I'm going to see if he wants to brawl.
Alright, so you go over to him, you raise your fist, and he's like, oh, another contender! And you two line up to fight.
Oh, boy.
I've got them... No, because I drank that the thing I made.
Yeah, let's see what effects of that.
It's a 1d6 inspiration.
Yeah, you get inspiration of that, and we're also stage 1 inebriated now.
I am instantly stage 1? Okay.
Yes, it's a very potent drink.
Yeah.
Actually, no, that's stage 1 in inspiration. So when you get to stage 1, your inspiration die is 1d6.
That's okay.
Yeah, sorry. It's a little too concise to be legible. Okay, so you're fighting him. Go ahead and make, do three, just basic attack rolls with your fists.
Oh my god!
You got one really good one.
Woof, ka-crow, woof.
Right. So you take a swig of your drink, and you feel like maybe the drink's starting to help you a little bit. With your first swing, you're distracted by this odd new feeling. And with your second swing, you feel a little bit more strength, maybe a little more flexibility in your joints. And you deliver a mighty blow and crack him right underneath his chin. In the meantime, you manage to suffer just 2 points of damage from the other guy. But you manage to knock him right out with that second hit. And he just drops right to the floor. And everyone around you cheers. Arr!
Woo!
Sweet.
What's everyone else doing?
I'm going to get up on the stage and try to perform with my buddies.
Drinking.
Okta knew that, and so drinking. she went and bought a drink and is just sitting right in front of the stage going like, yeah!
I will join
and
her.
When Valla gets up on the stage, she's like, hey everyone, call me Buffy.
Buffy.
Buffy. Oh, I got a
So you step up, Buffy. And everyone recognizes you. Like, oh, hey, Valla's back. Valla, yeah. Everybody loves you. They recognize you. The two performers on stage are like, how you doing, Missy? It's good to see you back. And then you yell that out, and everyone's like, oh, Buffy's back! And they're all very excited.
It would have worked better in a place they didn't know you.
And you get into a power stance and you strum your guitar and everyone cheers and you play the best song you have in a long time. And everyone is blown away. They start tossing money at you. A ton of copper rains down on you. You manage to get...
Ow.
You manage to get altogether 30 copper pieces.
Oh,
land
wow.
on the stage, and you can pick them all up if you want.
I do. Yes.
And everyone else is drinking, I'm assuming. Mm-hmm. Having a good time.
Yeah, I'm just enjoying the show.
I'm next to I'm at the table with Octa. Just chilling, having some drinks.
The barkeep comes over. He gives you a hearty smile. Be like, you folks come in with Valla there. I mean, Buffy, excuse me.
We sure did.
Hi.
Oh, yeah, well, normally I'd say she always has a free room here, but I can't really offer the same to you guys. You want to stay here for the night?
I'd appreciate it.
I'd certainly love to.
All right, that's just a one silver a night for each of you.
Works for me.
I have a decent amount of quarters for you. Hand will show you to where they are later on if you like. But for now, just enjoy the show. Valla's putting on a good one tonight.
Hold, sir. What's your strongest drink in the house?
We have gotten a new brand of whiskey from the dwarves, if you'd like to give that a try.
Heck yeah!
All right.
Is it
that's...
Dragonfire whiskey?
You've had Dragonfire whiskey before.
Valla has, apparently.
Apparently Valla's like, hell yeah, whiskey!
I'll just take a
Dragonfire is the stuff I drank in that drinking competition, isn't it?
It is.
That's what Biggles say.
Is that what I'm trying right now? Oh, snap.
So he brings
Don't
out this
keep that
small
away from
bottle
me.
Of...
No.
I'm going to, because I do want to try and drink this without getting completely smashed, I am going to eat my wisp's breath prior to chugging it.
Okay. So for the sake of this, you have an additional constitution worth of drinks you can consume. Excuse me. So he brings out this small bottle of this thick green and red liquid that's swirling around itself like some sort of flame in a bottle. He pours you just a tiny, almost a thimbleful of it, and he gives you a little bit. Vic, I'm assuming you're going to want some.
As do I.
All right, he pours you some too. Pow, he pours you a little bit. And you
Octa,
all drink it down.
Octa almost looks offended at the amount he gave her, but then goes, it's probably a smart move.
Yeah, he gives everyone the same amount because that's all he believes people can afford. He'd be like, yeah, it's a gold per glass, unfortunately. It's
glass.
Pretty expensive stuff.
Glass.
Yeah.
I'll buy the round for us.
He's like, oh, thank you, sir. That's mighty kind of you. He takes your gold, gives you your glasses, and as you drink, you feel like, you know, very much how Vic experienced before. You have the feeling of a dragon breathing down your neck and into your throat and into your stomach. It just fills you with such tremendous heat that you feel like you might be melting from the inside out, but you survive.
Octa is like, Marash Magla! Shouts out this war cry.
Do I have a panic attack because it's hot?
What's that?
Do I have a panic attack because it's hot?
Go ahead and make a constitution check.
Constitution save or check?
Are you just going to go all Frankenstein on us and be like, fire!
Which one am I doing?
Brad, is it a save or a check?
Just a check.
Yeah,
yes. Good. So you feel like maybe you've grown a little bit in the past, you know, week and a half. a little bit better about fire. You feel the confidence from your friends filling you, and the drink isn't hurting at all because it's kind of loosening you up a little bit. But the seeming flame of the drink doesn't really affect you at all. You take it down, and you're like, whatever, man.
All right.
Valla, when she gets done off stage, she goes and she orders, you know, some mead, and then she gets up and she's like, everybody, you gotta listen to this. And she starts to recount the story of how they just slayed the Minotaur and how he exploded.
Yeah.
So you recount the story. Go ahead and make another performance check for this.
Okay.
Bring Doc on to stage.
Oh, please do. I can't imagine his character would be like so awkwardly uncomfortable, like, but comfortable to like tell people about people.
Oh yeah, he is not one for the limelight.
We don't try and push him at a stage. I was just talking about him.
Okay, so you start to recount the story, and pow, you're pushing Doc up on the stage. Doc, you're a little bit looser now because you drank a little bit, but you're still not like in a state where you're like comfortable with this sort of situation. So you're resisting. Are you resisting heavily or just enough to be like embarrassed?
Enough to be embarrassed. I don't think I'm gonna do. I'm not gonna do anything reckless or could be potentially harmful.
Okay, so you're trying to push back. Pow, you're pushing him forward, and he's not resisting enough to stop you, but you can tell there's some like lean back on you right now. Come on. You get up on stage, and Valla, you tell your tale about how this magnificent shiny warrior of the dragon god, you know, smashed skeletons to bits, and his holy light filtered down from the sky and blasted them apart. And everyone cheers, and they you know, pull up a rousing chorus, and the people on the stage still, they begin to play an even more exciting tune, a little bit more epic, perhaps.
And as she regales us with this story of the dragon smashing skeletons, Vic kind of shrugs his shoulders, rolls him around a bit, and pulls off on the one leather thong thing holding his shirt together and kind of rolls it down his back and flexes and goes, "Ah, the dragon's breathing." And does whatever he can to make the dragon flex across his back.
Yeah. So everyone who's in his vicinity, you see on his tattoo, there's a faint glow around the edges of a... let's see, what was the color did you pick?
Bronze.
Yeah, so you see a faint, almost golden glow around the edge of his tattoo, and you see maybe a little bit of smoke coming off of his skin, but you don't see anything melting. It's just like a sort of a, almost like an effect to it. Nice. So as you drink and you have a good time, you guys gonna do anything else before the night's done?
Not really.
Doc's probably gonna head off early to his room after sort of feeling embarrassed, but I will say Doc tried to use that as a way to just say that, you know,
preach Bahamut.
Yeah, just not preach it, but just say I've got Bahamut to thank. to keep the world rid of such evil undead horrors.
Undead horrors.
Undead horrors, yes.
Bahamut.
And a guy's like,
"Zombie prostitute.
I hate undead whores."
What sort of house did we wander into?
They're so old.
You have no bedside manner. So Doc, you go off the bed.
As I like walk off the stage and walk up, I say, "Visit your local Bahamut temple."
Bahamut.
And everyone cheers, like, "Yeah!" But everyone sort of like talks to themselves, like, "I'm never gonna do that."
Yeah, local Bahamut tub. Woo!
So Doc, as you get to your room and you find, you know, modest accommodations, a pretty comfortable bed. You kneel down for your evening prayer for Bahamut, and you feel his presence on you. You feel a tremendous calling, almost like he's driving you even further and harder than he was before. How do you respond to this?
I will say, I hear your call, Bahamut. I know it now is time for my oath. And because I didn't write anything, because I just thought of it now... But essentially, Doc will recite an oath very specific to paladins who have been called by Bahamut. Like I said, if I had something prepared of what it sounded like, I would, but I didn't.
Okay. All right. I thought you were leading up to like saying something on the spot. That's
fine. I've been bad on the spot tonight.
Don't worry about it.
Need more improv classes, pal.
Yeah.
Scales of my shield.
your breath as my weapon. I will rid the world of all of your incursions.
There yeah, so you go.
You hear this slightly warbly but very deep voice speak in your ear. And each line it says, it you recite line after line, and you feel Bahamut's warmth with each light, with each line, fill your body. And as you fall asleep that night, you feel this subtle change coming about you, but you don't really know what's going to come of it quite yet. All right, everyone else.
All right. I'm ready to start leveling up right now.
You can go ahead and start doing your level up stuff. It's going to be in the
morning. No, it's all right. So.
It's just
too distracted morning, by it.
So you're easily. All right, okay. So you guys, you doing anything else before the night's done? You going to sleep? What are you doing?
Just going to sleep.
I'm going to contemplate.
Let's get on with it.
My prize is drink. As I
you're gonna.
Well, I'm gonna talk to people, just like catch up with some old friends and stuff until like fairly, you know, like around like 1 or 2 in the morning, and then I'm gonna go to sleep.
Okay. Hal, what did you say you were doing?
I'm sorry, gonna you kinda complete upon my prize drink that I have.
Okay.
And before I go to sleep, pack it away.
Go. Okay. All right. All right, so you guys all make your way to bed. Some of you thinking about certain things. Some of you having just left the fondness of company that you've missed for a while.
I need to be using this. Sorry, I just looked up my thaumaturgy cantrip. I can make demonic stuff happen.
Always.
So you find your way to bed, and in the morning, you all feel refreshed, but even more so than you do. You feel stronger. You're now level 3.
Yeah, which means I can also cast Hellish Rebuke.
Oh, there's lots I can do now.
I'm not hungover.
It seems to be scary now.
Yeah, I'll go through my level up process once we're done.
Yeah, me
okay.
too.
For the very least, while we're just sort of talking, go ahead and roll your hit dice to add your HP, just so you have that in case something happens.
Do I roll?
Yeah, so you guys all wake up. Unfortunately, you don't smell the beautiful breakfast you're used to smelling that Doc usually cooks for you when you were in Astora. But you do smell a little bit of a breakfast, maybe not the best food.
Quick question. Yeah. Sorry. Do I just roll a 1d10 then?
1d10 whatever your hit dice your con.
Oh. So 2d10.
No, just one hit dice.
Whatever, it's asking me for my input value.
No, you just type /roll(1d10).
Yeah. That's what I thought.
I just mean roll whatever dice is.
I can't remember what mine's supposed to be.
Is it not written down in your sheet?
Come on, really?
Oh, that's
no, that's what I'm saying. My hit dice is 2 out of 2.
No, it's. I'm saying your hit dice as a die, like a d8 or a d10.
Okay.
That's what you roll.
You're not actually rolling your hit die.
So Valla, in your case, you have a d8, so you roll a d8 for that.
Oh, okay. So I just roll a 1d8.
Yeah. Kyle, so then you add the result of that plus your constitution to your max.
Fuck!
And weakest barbarian ever.
Well, that's really unfortunate for you.
Oh, you people suck.
That's 2 levels in a roll now.
Well, slash R.
Put the slash before the roll.
I have
26. 9, 32. 23. So, you just add that to the hit points. 25.
Add that to your max and current.
28.
I know.
Oh, yeah.
25. Huzzah. I'm so strong. Guys, I'm so strong. I'm even so bad.
If you don't forget to increase the level on your character sheet as well under your character tab. Because that'll add all your special effects and the like, but at least most of them.
You just change that up on next to where it says like Fighter 2 for me or whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
I can't edit that.
Are you in edit mode?
All this stuff came back.
Oh, there it goes. I'm good. Sorry.
All right. So you guys wake up. The city's open to you. It's bright and early in the morning. You know you have to be at the Caravan Palace by nightfall. What do you want to do?
I'm going to head off toward... I'm going to fucking... I really would like to see the moon perch.
Okay.
If anyone wants to come with.
Woo!
How long will it take to... Yeah, how long it'll take to get there?
Doesn't seem too far, right? I can get there and back.
So you head to the edge of the city, which you're pretty close to, and you look out on the landscape, and you try to estimate the distance to Moonperch, as large a mountain as it is, and you see that it would probably take you a day's journey to get there.
Mm, dang.
As far as you can tell.
All right.
Dane's here? No, I'm kidding.
All right.
Valla, as some of you may know, knows the city pretty well. She guided you to the Gleaner, so if you have any questions about the city, she's available. She has some knowledge about it.
Octa is actually... I sound quieter for some reason to me. Anyway, Octa is going to just kind of wander about the city a little bit. People watch.
Okay.
Valla tries to catch up with her and be like, Octa, I've got the place for you.
Oh, what? Yeah? Where am I going?
I don't know if we have enough time to do it today, but there's a brawling ring. And I think yes.
What?
It's called the Golden Pit.
The Golden Pit. Yeah. Alright, we gotta tell Pao, too.
Okay. We go tell him, I guess.
Go tell Pao. Awesome.
Where? You manage to catch him as he's going out the door to look at the moon perch. Let him know what's going on at the Golden Pit.
You guys want to go check out the Golden Pit?
Yes.
Does anybody else want to come?
I will pass, but thank you for the invitation.
Yeah, I'm good. I was going to maybe look into... Brad, the spell scroll that I got... Do I just know what that is, or do I have to have that identified?
Well, we need to
you have to have that identified.
Cloak too.
Yeah, I was gonna maybe see if I could find a magic parlor, whatever you want to call it, and maybe get our stuff checked out.
Okay.
I don't know of any magic.
I'll accompany him for now.
There is a smithy. I don't know if that would help though.
If I just do an investigation check, can I find a place?
You might be able. I might be able to take it to the academy later and have somebody at the academy, figure it out.
Oh, that's fine.
Yeah, I think he'll find it.
Yeah. So you.
Ben, are you lording over our game?
You find your way about the city, and you find a pretty small looking shop, but outside there's some bits staying from it that look like. Perhaps potion ingredients, maybe some arcane focuses. And you find your way inside, and at the desk there's a wizened old witch. She's got a large pointy hat and a big grin on her face.
Nice. Good day, madam.
Hey there, yes.
Oh my god.
I'm here for you.
I can't.
I'm sorry. Have I offended you, sir?
Not at all, ma'am. I apologize. I was wondering if you could take a look at a couple items I had and maybe identify them for me.
Yes, of course. It will cost you, of course.
Absolutely, not a problem. And I'll start with the scroll that I have.
Yes.
She bows over the scroll and reads it and waves her hands a little bit. Casts you see a spell come from her hands, a little bit of white light. She's like, yes,
I see. This is a scroll. It does the blink spell.
I see.
Yes.
Chris turned into a dog again.
Next, the cloak.
Yes. Oh, this would be quite expensive to identify.
How expensive are we talking about?
Perhaps 50 gold.
Oh my god!
To look at it, bitch, you cray. Octa's not there, so she didn't actually say.
How much was it for the scroll?
Oh, that's a mere just 1 gold for that, sir.
All right, very good.
You're scared for a minute there, weren't you, Peter?
That.
Don't worry about the cloak. I've got another idea.
I can take it to the academy and get it looked at, probably.
I bet there are students there that would love to look at it for you.
For free.
And then, what was the other thing we got?
The potion.
Oh, that's right, the potion. How much for the potion?
Yes, simple potion identifications. That is another 1 gold, sir.
That's please have her say good. My precious before you leave.
If you could please take a look at this then, too.
Yes, of course.
And she does the same sort of process.
Very precious to us.
That's good for you, I suppose.
She gives you a weird look out of the corner of her eye.
God damn it.
Because she had just identified the spell at that point. Or the potion. Like,
yes, this is a potion of love.
I see.
And it's two dudes! It's two dudes who just walked in with this. This potion of love is super precious to us. Please tell us what it is.
If you drink this potion, you become smitten with everyone you see.
Oh, everyone. All right.
Oh, Lord.
Good to know. Thank you.
We didn't get anything else, right? That was it?
No, that was it.
Yep.
Those were the only things we didn't identify.
Yeah. All right. Then I will say thank you very much. Do you, by chance, have any healing potions for sale?
My supplies are running low.
And I'm burping.
You couldn't burp in the old lady voice?
You burp in the old lady voice.
That's the best I got.
Yes, it will be about 70 gold, if you wish.
God, these people!
Hi.
They're expensive.
Yeah. Hi.
Maybe not today, but thank you very much.
Yes, of course, sir. Is there anything else you might find interesting?
No, I don't think so. I think I'm good for today.
Very good. Very good. Yes, have a fine day, sir.
You too.
Sirs. Enjoy that potion.
And she gives you a big old old lady wink.
Ooh, that smells good.
That's all I wanted to do today.
All right, Valla and Octa, you guys have made your way over to the
and
Golden
Pal.
Pit by now. And Pal, that's right. You made your way over to the Golden Pit. Valla, you're
just
familiar
like
with the place.
Watch, by the way.
Yeah, you're familiar with the place, and you know that they don't really do anything until later in the evening, like around 5 or 6 in the afternoon, evening. So you go there, and there's a few people milling about, maybe some people cleaning up the arena from last night, but there's really nothing going on there.
I start looking around and, you know, just kind of getting a feel for the place, seeing what might be going on. Or if anybody's prepping, maybe training.
Sometimes they do executions.
Okay. Passing guy sort of gives you a weird look, like, yeah. Did you come here to see an execution?
Not yet.
Oh, good lord.
He just runs away. Like, he's got something in his arm. Hurries away.
It's weird for...
Valla mumbles something like, you just wait till I get my hands on that guy that was by the docks.
Okay. So yeah, that happens. Vic, or what are you up to? I know you've been busy for the last few minutes. You know what you want to do for the day?
When we were fighting the undead, the skelly punks, when my blows were landing, did they feel like they were hurting them less than they should have been? Less than I would expect them to if I were hitting, say, a human.
You didn't really notice any reduction in the amount of damage you were doing. You felt like they were pretty good strikes, but you didn't feel any difference to it. It felt pretty standard to you. Not as satisfying as a fleshy blow, but you know.
Right. So I'm debating if I want to go find myself a spare weapon, something more in the crushy flatty market.
Crushy flatty. I'm tempted to grab something myself.
And some kind of I want something similar in the damage range as a great axe, but more bludgeoning.
Okay. So go ahead and make have for Valla left. Did you perhaps ask her where a good store to be would?
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, that would make sense for me to do.
Okay. All right. So Vella's like, well, guys, there's Finric's Blades. There's no better place in the city than this place. I love the owner. She's fantastic. You know, tell her that, you know, I sent you guys. And, you know, and I may even see you there later.
All right. So you make your way off to Fenric's. She tells you where it is. You find probably the largest smithy shop you've ever seen. It occupies pretty much the size of an entire city block.
God damn.
In the Follow, in the outer edge there. Of it.
Yes.
Hang on. What? Anyways, what? On the outer edge of it, there's a stall-like structure, various countertops. Each one seeming to correspond with a different sector of armoring or armor or weapons. You know, on one of the counters is lined up where all the armor is displayed out front. The other one perhaps is slashing blades. The other one's bludgeoning weapons. You know, they're all sort of evenly divided into several sort of departments, if you will. And in the center, in the midst of all those stall openings, is a large, a huge smithy area. There's you know, 20 anvils, and there's like four or five furnaces, and there's all sorts of work being done, constant noise of pounding and steam and work coming from the center of the shop.
I'm going to go ahead and bring that gigantic Minotaur axe with me. I figure if anybody's going to be able to get valid use or interest out of it, it's going to be a smithy.
Okay.
I'll walk up to... I'm hoping there's someone there that looks like they're a... either a chief proprietor or the person that discusses weapons or somebody not actively hammering at that instant. Yeah. If not, then I'll just look for whoever seems to be both working on axes and working on hammers. Like those kinds of people.
So you find your way over to one section where you see it's sort of like a junction on the corner between where the main body of the axes are displayed, as well as around the corner where the hammers and larger weapons, flails and the like, are being displayed. Somewhat nearby, there's a woman of a relatively stocky build. She appears to be calling out orders to the people in the middle in the smithy. At the counter, there's a person there available. He receives you. Yes, sir. What can I do for you?
Oh, in the market for a maul of some sort. Big strapping, something that I can use to really just flatten anything that gets in my way. I've got myself a good axe. I can split things. But really just need something to crush, and was hoping either just gold for trade, or perhaps if this would interest you in any way, shape, or form, we could do a little bit of bartering. I'll set that Minotaur's axe down on whatever looks to be a desk or table in front of her.
Yeah, so you set that down, and he's pretty shocked when you first pull it off from behind your back, because that's probably the biggest axe he's seen in a long time. Whoa! Oh, that's quite an axe. Where did you get something like that?
Well, mates and I were headed up here to see if we can't do something about these caravans going missing, getting attacked, and saw this ramshackle little house that it looked like it might have been a spot where bandits, you know, would stage and hide. And whilst we were in there, one of the lasses went down in the basement, and we all kind of traipsed along, making sure there wasn't anything going to jump out at us. And while we were down there, there was a couple undead, handful of skeletons, and this one big nasty punk looked like a Minotaur. Had that big beast there on him. Luckily, one of the guys I'm with is I guess you might call him a paladin of sorts of. Some dragon god, Muhammad. He's always prattling on about. Yeah, he did something, and the little bastard scattered all the winds. But I figured I like me some axes. Got a couple. Might as well add one to the collection and see if I can find someone that liked it better than me, or waited to help me.
Yeah. Well, I can't rightly say how much we could buy this for. We don't get much call for gigantic axes like this. You know, the giants usually keep them themselves, but. You know what? Let me talk to my boss and see what she can do for you. In the meantime, if you're looking for a mall yourself, maybe step around the corner. You might be able to find something. So he goes and he talks with the woman. You know, sort of pointing back at the giant axe, which is clearly visible from anywhere in the room. And he, you know, she comes back over after a little while, be like, hello, sir. My name's Venora Fenrix. I'm the proprietor of this fine establishment, the largest smith in Vorakis. We're quite proud of that, sir. What can I do for you?
Oh, I heard nothing but good things. Valla, a friend of mine, pointed me over this way. I'm looking to get a mall. I need something big, crushy, flatty type activity. Telling the lad here that while we were up on our way here, we ran across a little thing where we got these skeletons attacked us, and one of them was this big old minotaur, and had this thing swinging around like a fool.
Yeah, my guy was telling me here. So you're looking to sell it, you say?
Sell it, barter it. Good trading stock. I figure I'm not going to be able to heft it with any real gusto, but who knows? You might be able to get enough metal out of it to make a good something. Reforge it, recast it, possibly split it off into some smaller axes. And really, maybe if it's not something you think you'd sell, we could work out some sort of deal where you make something for me out of it, replace these little hand axes with something a little stronger, and look at working a mull into the deal somewhere.
Yeah. You know what? I have a guy who likes weird stuff. I might be able to buy that off of you, but you know, if you want to trade it, we could do a little bit of a trade. I might have to. I wouldn't feel right giving you just the. You were looking for a mall, was it?
Yeah, something big, heavy, and smashing. If you got any that are any higher quality or any maybe that finger waggling stuff on it, make it hit a little harder. I'd be interested in anything like that, or really just upgrading any of the cutting implements I've got. You know, anything to slash better is good for me.
Yeah. You know what? We've got a pretty nice morning star. That'll run you usually around 20 gold, because it's pretty well put together. It's a little bit, the spikes on it are a little bit sharper, so that might be a nice deal for you. But tell you what, I'll take this giant axe off your hands for, let's say, 30 gold, and I'll give you the Morning Star for free, part of the deal.
That'll work.
Yeah. All right.
Works for me.
So she goes over to the next counter. She finds this particularly wicked-looking Morning Star. It's got several spikes all over the ends of it. Clearly designed to pierce a little bit more and tear a bit more of flesh whenever it hits. But she brings it over to you. She sets it down and picks up that giant axe. And she picks it up with relative ease. She appears to be a very strong and durable woman. Picks it up, takes it over to a storage area somewhere near the center of the area and sets it down. She calls back to the guy front, hey, give him that 30 gold you're talking about. And then she sets it down and does some paperwork over at the desk.
Can that be like, well, I was about to say, can that be like right when me and Valla walk in?
I was just about to say that. Right about this time, Valla and Octa, you guys walk up to Fenrik's fine arms. Valla, you're on the lookout for your friend, Fenora Fenrix. You remember her from your times spent hanging out and charming her and whatnot. And she's over in the center of the area. She's dealing with
check out these arms.
A giant axe. You see Vic over there actually handling what looks like a pretty decent Morning Star.
Octa goes right up to him and goes, Let me see. Octa's like hefting it like, ooh.
And when the guy comes back with the gold, I'll ask him to pull out just a standard issue maul and find out how much that'll run me, and we'll settle up that one too.
Okay. So he's like, Yeah, I got you one. Just 10 gold for this one. It's not terribly special, but it's a decent piece.
All right. Pass him back 10 of the gold that he gave me, and pass another 4 as a tip for good dealsmanship.
All right. So you now have a maul and a Morning Star. The Morning Star has a plus 2 to its damage rolls. So that's a little bit extra.
And nothing else extra on attack for those, right?
No, just a little bit extra damage on that one. It's not magic, unfortunately.
Yeah, yeah. Just making sure for getting it all input in here. And then just a standard SRD maul.
Exactly, yep.
Cool.
Well, Valla sees her friend, and she goes over to talk to her. She says, "Hey, how's it going?"
Well, hey, Valla, how you doing? It's been so long. You wanna get a drink later?
Yeah, definitely. We're staying over at the Gleaners, but we have a thing to do tonight. We're trying to find where these caravans are going missing.
Oh, yeah, that's been hitting me a bit, too. I can't really get my weapons out to dealers over in Nestora.
Well, that's horrible. Hopefully we figure it out and we tear someone a new asshole.
Yeah, tear him one for me.
Certainly, certainly will. Actually, I was going to ask you, are you carrying anything maybe a little bit better than my current armor? She looks down at her armor, or maybe even have some different pistols in that might do a little bit more damage than what I've got currently?
Oh, yeah. I mean, well, we don't really have any much better pistol-wise. I already gave you our best. I know you're worth it. But do you want, like, something heavier, maybe?
Yeah. Well, what you got? What you got in mind?
Well, we got some studded leather. It's like your armor right now, but it's got little bits of metal all over it.
So I'll look badass?
Even more than you do now. It's going to be hard, but yeah.
This person is charming you up.
Well, about how much would you sell it to me for?
That's not too cheap. But you know what? I like you. So let's say 40 gold?
Yeah, totally. And how about I give you 50?
Oh, you're a doll. Tell you what, I'll buy you a drink later, huh?
Oh, no, you have to let me buy you a drink.
I insist.
Okay, all right, sure. Maybe we could buy each other drinks, whatever.
Yeah.
Maybe, how about this? If we find these motherfuckers that's taking the caravans, I'll definitely buy you a drink.
Oh, those drinks. Okay. Pal, go ahead and make a survival. Go ahead and make investigation check. See if you can find shining armor, man.
Okta has been browsing their gauntlets.
Okay. So as you look around, you're on pretty much the opposite side of the shop that Vic is right now, counting out his money. And you find a nice array of what looks like pretty fine gauntlets. Some have spikes on the knuckles. Some are just standard plate gauntlets. Some are like sort of leather gloves with a little bit of metal on them for some durability. And a shop keeps them over and be like, "Hi, hello, ma'am. You looking for anything specific? Maybe something to adorn those pretty horns of yours."
Okta gives him a look like the what? No. Looking for something to adorn these, and holds her fists up.
Oh, this is a nice pair of man whackers there.
Okta's like, "I don't know if that means what you think it means, but sure." Yeah.
What else could it mean? You're using to punch guys, right?
Sure. That's exactly what I'm going to use them for. Yeah. That's what I'm personally planning on using them for, at least.
What else would you do with them?
So, how much do these run generally?
Well, so you're just getting the gauntlets, right? Nothing else? You're not going for anything else?
Well, I might browse around the other sections, but this is my primary concern at the moment.
Can I interest you in maybe a new sword or something? You looking for anything there?
I gesture down. I'm like, "Well, I've got swords covered at the moment, as you can see." And then I lift my glaive up a little bit. I'm like, "I have also got my ranged weapon a little bit, but I want some to be able to knock some people around if they come in close."
Okay. Yeah, all right. So we got these nice spike gauntlets. They give you a little bit more oomph when you're punching people.
Zelda?
The music.
Okay.
So yeah, you know, if you're looking for these, I'd say they're gonna be probably about 40, 45 gold. Let's say 45 because you know, they are pretty nice.
45, you said?
45, that's right.
That's tempting. Now, what kind of deal may I get if I maybe upgrade my current sword or glaive?
You know, we might be able to cut you a little bit of a combo discount, you know, if you're looking for maybe something new. Let's walk on over to the swords and see what you want.
Yeah, and I shout over my shoulder, Valla, come help me pick something out!
At this point, Valla, you're still talking to Fenora.
My ears perk up, and I look at Fenora, and I say, excuse me for just one moment, my friend needs my help really quick.
Yeah, alright, Valla, see you later.
Yeah, well, we need to have that drink as soon as we're done with the caravan problem.
Yeah. She goes back to her business. And
the way you're talking, I really can't tell how interested this lady is in actually talking to Valla or not.
Well, you're not listening to her, so...
I'm not. I'm just commenting on their conversation, I guess, as a person listening to it.
As a person.
Not as a tiefling, not listening to out of my ear range.
Okay, so the clerk guides you over to the swords, slaps one of his fellow co-workers on the back, and she gives him a little bit of an evil look, but she's just mildly annoyed at him, really. You looking for a sword or something? This guy says you're looking for a nice new blade, maybe.
I look at her, and then I look at the guy who brought me over and said, all right, well, I'll talk to you if I go back over to the gauntlet section. And I'm looking at this lady, and I pull out my current short sword and show it to her and say, what you got that I might be able to make this a little bit more useful? Or something better.
Yeah, are you looking to keep it the same size? Do you want, like, maybe something bigger?
Well, what do you got?
Well, we've got a nice selection of long swords. They're, you know, a little bit longer, a little bit heavier, maybe deal a bit more damage if you like them. And we've got great swords, and she gestures over to a stand of swords that are several feet tall, even taller than you, some of them. Yeah, we've got those great swords over there. Those are real heavy hitters. You got to be pretty strong to carry one, but boy, do they do the job.
It sure seems like they would.
A huge sword.
I would absolutely love to have a giant sword, but realistically, probably shouldn't try to swing one of those without, you know, having a giant radius of people who I like not near me.
What about a katana?
Oh, that'd be cool.
I don't really know what a katana is, man.
It's something that the Kitsune people would create, but
what are they probably Kitsune?
Yeah. Who?
What are they? I've never heard of that, man.
They're beings that tend to hide away from most common places. Anyway,
I never heard of them.
Yes, we tieflings tend to see some of the lesser known races due to our own reasons for leaving the more crowded areas. So, as she's talking, Octa is hefting any all of the swords, the short swords that are well within the same range of the one that she currently has, and seeing if any of them seem to fit her more than the current sword she has.
So you look around and you see a few nicely crafted ones, but you see one that that appears to have a little bit of an aura about it. It perhaps maybe a little bit magical, but it's just as well crafted as any of the others. You just notice a little bit more oomph to it visually.
What about this one? And I hold it up.
Oh, that one.
Get away from that cat.
Those are pretty expensive. you might not be able to afford that. I don't know. That's one of our more magical weapons.
I can feel that.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're not just going to straight up tell me the price, are you?
Well, you know, I don't want to, like, I don't want to give you a conniption or anything.
No, but you're almost more offending me by just not telling me.
Yeah, yeah, it's going to be like, it's going to be like 200 gold.
All right. Could have just said that in the beginning.
Yeah, I
would
just
have saved,
you know,
us a little bit of time.
I don't want to, you know, drive people away with huge prices, you know. I want to be fair about this, so.
It's a magic sword! If they don't expect it to be pricey, they shouldn't be asking for the price. And Octa hangs it back up. I can't afford a 200 gold sword, are you kidding? Even if I can't buy it with the gauntlets, too. So I say, well, thank you for your time. I go back over to the gauntlets, and I pick up a pair of, lightly spiked. They're not really, like, they're not going to be, like, super pointy or anything. They kind of have, like, studs on the knuckles.
Okay.
And I try a pair of those on, see how they feel.
All right. So you get a feel for these. The clerk welcomes you back and helps you adjust them to fit your hands. He's like, yeah, these will do you good. You know, when you go to whack a man, you just give him a good punch and it does a decent amount of damage that way.
Watermelon marshmallows? What are we talking about? Aw, dude, so not fair. Anyway, so Octa's like, you know what? Yeah, we'll go with these. How much do these run?
Yeah, man, that was, what did I say, like 40 gold, right?
You said 40. Yeah, 40. You said 40. All right. Well, thanks for doing business with me, and do I have to buy them from him, or do I take them over to, like, a counter or whatever?
He just takes your gold.
Poking them?
The for studs.
Oh.
All right. So, in the meantime, Pow, you've been wandering around the city as everyone has been buying weapons. You've been looking around, trying to see, ear nor tail, of the your dragon friends. But unfortunately, you just sort of end up wandering around, and you end up in front of a kind of worn down looking building. It's not falling over by anything, but it's a little bit more run down than most of the other buildings around it. And you see outside, there's a little sort of penned in area where there's children running around and playing.
So, sort of like a rundown school?
Yeah, as best you can tell, it looks maybe like a school or an orphanage.
Anyone else around?
There is what appears to be an adult standing near the yard, just sort of watching over the kids.
That's awesome. Want those marshmallows.
Agreed.
I'm in the creepy part of town. I keep walking.
Okay.
Pal found the creepy part.
Go ahead and make a investigation check to see if you can find them this time.
Nope. Same error.
Lord.
That is actually rolling. Okay. I want to make sure. So you wander around the city a bit more, and you find Fenric's fine arms again. You're in front of the massive forge.
I'm gonna go in. I had an idea on the way over.
Okay. Where are you going? To any specific counter for any specific item, or what?
I want brass knuckles.
Brass knuckles. All right. So you find your way over. By this time, Valla and Valla and Octa and Vic, they sort of finish their business.
Mm.
We'll get to them in a minute. But you find your way over to the counter with the gauntlet guy, and he's like, "Hey, I don't know what you are, but I'm looking to sell you some gauntlets. What do you want?"
I'm a Venaran. Just Venaran, name's Pow. I want some brass knuckles.
All right. Pow, I like that name. That's a good punching name.
I don't like this guy.
I didn't realize that. Still P-A-U, though.
But you looking for some man whacking.
No, he likes man whacking.
That sounds wrong.
I know!
But yeah, I'm looking for some brass knuckles.
Brass knuckles, all right. And he leads you over. There's a display case with several fine examples, some encrusted with jewels, some just simple metal knuckles, some with designs like skulls and the like on them. So you see a selection. There's some simple ones, some more serious looking ones. Any in particular you see that grab your eye, perhaps?
Is there anything simple with a very like wooden kind of feel to it?
Yeah. So you look around. There's one in the corner that has a nice sort of wood handle to it. It's a good grip on it. And the other end is
like polished back part,
like oak or mahogany or something.
What's that wooden set back there?
Yeah, man, that's a nice one. We got a guy who makes those for us. He lives off in the woods. He doesn't really come out much, but he makes good stuff. Here, go ahead and give it a feel. And he opens up the display case and hands it to you.
Is there anything to punch nearby?
There's the counter, there's the display case, there's the guy in front of you, but that's
there's no dummies around?
There's no dummies, unfortunately.
Alright. Just gonna kinda punch the air. Does it feel like it would increase my capabilities?
Yeah, you from what you understand about how you know your fists work and how extra force would be distributed, you feel like these would add just like a little bit more damage when you strike. They wouldn't really change too much how you fight, but they would give you some room.
How much for them?
Yeah, man. These are gonna run you. Let's see. They're gonna run you probably about 60 gold, I'd say. They're finely handcrafted pair of not really brass knuckles, they're more like bush knuckles, I guess you could call them.
Funny. Sure. Take him.
Yeah. All right.
His bark would be worse than his bite.
I don't know what it is with travelers today, but I've had a ton of people come to me, and not one of you has tried to barter. It's crazy.
I'm not the best talker.
I am shit at bartering, man. I ain't doing that.
I'm not a good talker.
Even Doc would. Even Doc would try. Like, come on, guys.
Hey, I sort of bartered with the people. I traded him an axe for a thing.
This isn't the same guy, so he doesn't even know about you.
I did a deal with my friend, so...
I'll barter if they sell these. That's the wrong thing. Damn it.
If they sell men flexing their chest?
I clicked on the wrong thing.
But, so what are the...
Hang on.
Gauntlets do?
So they basically use your same punch, but they add... they change the dice to the next dice up. So whatever it is now, it'll be the next dice up for that.
So now from a D4 to a D6?
Yeah.
Nice.
That counts as my unarmed?
Yep.
Will that always happen as I increase my unarmed strike?
Yeah. Well, to a certain point. We'll talk about it in the future.
Okay. Yeah. Brad, I'm going to discuss mine with you once we're done.
Okay.
The freaking... badger rat things.
Yeah. Okay, so you guys have done your shopping. Doc and Arcus, what are you guys up to after you're done with your potions? It's getting to be about midday, you guys.
I just figured we'd go hang out at the tavern or something. Like, not drinking anything excessive.
I'm gonna make a stop at whatever local church is here for Bahamut, if there is one or not. See if I can ask around to find one.
Right, so you guys split off. Make an investigation check. Arcus, you head back to the tavern, grab yourself a pint, and settle in for a little bit. Vic, I'm guessing you said you're heading back for a drink?
Yeah.
All right. So, Doc, you look around, and as you're walking about, you don't really find any chapel or anything. You do see a few other churches, but they don't appear to have any... dragon-based symbolism around them, so they're probably not Bahamuts. But you do manage to find your way in front of what looks like a large spiky building. It looks like maybe a cathedral or something, but much larger. And you see several robed and hooded figures passing in and out of its doors.
Is it a cult?
Do they look like busy, like they're doing a ritual, or are they just walking in and out?
Most of them are holding what appears to be books or scrolls. You know, some are talking to each other, some are reading as they walk. you know, all appear to be studying of some sort, but none of them are.
Are any of them whacking themselves in the head?
No, that is not the case.
Dang. I'll go to somebody who looks like they're just discussing and says, excuse me, gentlemen, do you have a moment if I could ask a question?
One of the guys looks up and be like, yeah, what do you
want?
I was just curious if you knew of any Bahamut temples or chapels here in this fine city.
Yeah, there's one across town. It's pretty close to the place where all the carts and stuff go.
Oh, it's by the caravan palace. Fantastic.
Yes, that's it. That's the one.
May I ask who this church is for?
Oh, this is no church. Although you could say it's a church of the mind.
Church of the mind? What do you mean? Is this a school? Yes.
This is the Twilight Academy. This is the finest magical establishment in all of Volcana.
Oh, well, that is good to know. Thank you very much, sir. I appreciate your time.
Of course, of course. Are you a paladin yourself?
Indeed I am. May I ask your name, sir? I am Doc Thunderbrand, of course, and I extend my hand to meet his.
I'm Steppen.
Steppen, it's a pleasure to meet you, Steppen.
As in, I'm stepping away because I hate paladins. Bye. And he just walks.
I knew you were leading up to something. That was
shit.
Roasted.
The other guy like gives you a look like, yeah, I'm sorry about that, dude. I'm Craig.
It's all right, Craig. I'll be on my way.
Okay. See you later.
Oh, you're good.
Stepping away. Love it.
Oh God! I was like, "That's a weird ass name," but I like it.
I thought it was just you mispronounced Steven.
Valla goes up to Octa and says, "Look, I'm pokey now," and she starts poking all of her studs.
Octa starts poking the studs like with the gauntlet studs of the gauntlets. Like, look, I'm pokey too. Pokey poke, pokey poke.
I can punch.
So, what's that, pal?
I can punch better. Even better than before.
We're like porcupine.
Octa looks at Pow and is like, Pow, we need to like make a super epic fist bump move that we can do if something cool okay. happens.
All right, like, this is all back to the tavern.
This is all back on the way, not in the shop.
Okay, yeah. I pick up my morning star and say, look, I got pokies too.
Yeah, we all got pokies!
We all poke stuff. Am I not very pokey? Mine are just... harder to hit.
And we'll use these with people we need to train. So we can all be pokey trainers.
Yeah, man.
The four of you are going to make your way back to the tavern, have a drink.
Yeah.
And for those that are now traveling with, if you're actually looking at Vic, he's got some things that look different. He's got what looks like scales starting around his eyes and on his elbows, and his eyes now look.
Hey, Vic, something's going on with your face.
Dude, I think you need to moisturize more.
I think he looks great. What about you, Doc? I think he looks fantastic.
You look like them.
I've never seen anything more fantastic.
I mean,
other than Bahamut, of course.
Keep doing it.
Soon enough, he'll look just like us.
What do you mean?
You.
Vic still doesn't know. So.
You look dragon-ish.
Bring him over to like any sort of.
I'll walk over to
I'm
Doc.
I'm gonna pull out.
I'm gonna come over to Doc, who is shiny.
Oh, there you go. Bring him over to Doc's breastplate and just.
I was gonna say, look at the thing that we have.
I polish it up real quick with my cape, make sure it's nice and extra shiny.
Well, that's weird. Guess that dragon fire hit me a little hard.
I don't know. I drank it. I don't
know. Maybe I should find a bottle.
Do you want to be more dragon?
Well, can't hurt.
I mean, these guys seem to be pretty good at it.
Can't hurt
Cool.
So, Doc, do you actually go back to the tavern? Is that what I'm assuming? Are you still going to try to look for a chapter house?
Oh, yeah, I was looking around the city. I forgot.
What are you looking around the city for?
I was looking to see if... Watch people. Look at people.
I'm going
to
go... What time of day is it by now?
It's approaching mid-afternoon. The sun is descending about halfway through the sky.
All right, I'll head back to the tavern, and I'll try to visit it either when we're done here, or maybe leave a little bit early before we plan to meet at the caravan palace, seeing as it's so close.
Okay. So yeah, you guys make it back to the tavern. The rest of you have been there for the most part already. And as you're sitting there, and as Doc comes in, go ahead and everybody who might be not paying attention to the drink, make a perception check.
I actually wanted to also.
I'll be back in 1 second.
You know, I'm paying attention to the drink, but I wanted to ask the owner if I
should really. I should really have worked on my perception, considering my part of my goal is to look for a person.
Go on, Ian. What are you saying?
Yeah, I wanted to.
What are we doing? The perception.
Have any wine gourds for sale that could hold a pretty good amount of wine or beer in it?
We don't really use gourds. I mean, that's kind of a primitive way of storing drink, in my opinion. But
I'm going to be able to carry on me and drink at all times.
You're not the first person to ask that. We do have some nice wineskins to hold a bit more, if you're looking for that.
I think a bigger wineskin.
Yeah. You know what? Yeah, that's about five silver, if you got it.
Sorry about that.
Sure.
All right. You're not the first person to ask about that.
How so?
Yeah, we've had some other strange characters you're like come in asking about wine or, gourds and the like. Drinking.
Did they ever talk about a tale of a never-ending wine gourd?
You know, let me think here. You know what? Yeah, they did. They did mention that. They kept asking about it, mostly when they got drunk. They seemed to think it was a real thing.
Yeah, it might not be a real thing. What did they look like? Besides looking like me.
Well, they tended to hide themselves a little bit more than you are, maybe wearing cloaks and the like. There was this one feller who, he did mention it. He wasn't really asking, but he was wearing a big old hat. I remember that.
Big old hat.
What do you mean you mentioned it? Do you mention where it could be?
No, he just sort of, he talked about it. He told a story about it.
Can I get that story?
Oh, that was a long time ago. I remember I liked it a lot, but,
don't remember enough of it.
It was a really good story, but I don't remember it.
Dang. No details about it?
No. He mentioned Moon Perch a little bit, but they all go to Moon Perch, so I figure you already know that.
I did, actually.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thanks anyway. I'll take that wineskin.
Yeah. It's all yours.
And then... All right, now can you fill it with pretty strong, something quite strong?
Yeah. I've got a nice potent wine from Kexis. They make some good wine down there.
Kexis.
Is it bigger than everyone else?
No, I just realized that, and no, it's not.
All right. How much to fill it?
And now just to fill this up, that's just a couple silver. It's not too expensive, but it's a nice strong drink.
Okay.
Right. So you guys, you're all at the tavern. You're all hanging out. You bought your wine and your wineskin. And at this point, a familiar face walks in. Actually, no. You roll perception. That's why I had to roll perception. You see a familiar face in the corner. Arcus and Doc and... Octa, the three of you notice in the corner is one of your old person you've seen before. It's the guy you ran into whenever you were at the Grand Adventures Expo, Demoth Barno.
The guy who led us into the alley?
And then yeah. Yeah. Like a skimpering
one. The very first
what
guy.
The?
I have the a cookie. Hell? I can show him now.
Who that dude? What he doing here?
Was that who English?
No. It was not. I don't know why I talked like that.
It was really common.
Arcus is gonna, like, motion over to him. Is he, like, looking in our direction? Is he facing away?
He's just
like
sort of looking
Strider
about. What's that?
The Fellowship Ring, where he's, like, just sitting in a corner, like, looking all mysterious.
No, he's talking to a couple guys, having a drink. He appears to be focused on their conversation, but otherwise he's not looking over.
So, refresh my memory if I remember correctly. Demoth, runaway. did he see us take care of the Saurians in the alleyway, or did he run away beforehand? I couldn't remember if he ran before or after.
No, we separated with him afterwards.
Yeah, he was there whenever we beat them.
Again, it's Demoth.
Demoth Barno.
Demoth. I'm just going to call out Demoth and see if I can, like, wave him over to come sit with us.
He hears your call. Well, hey there! Yeah, 1 second! And he goes back conversation with people he's talking to, and he, you know, finishes up, be like, yeah, just 1 second, you know, give him, a finger up kind of thing. And he goes back over. Oh, how you lot doing? Looks like you've made it over this way pretty safely.
Yeah, indeed, we're in the area trying to take care of a caravan problem. Missing caravans.
Oh, really? Yeah, I've heard about that.
Yeah, so that's why we're here. What are you doing here?
Oh, yeah, I am, just doing a few odd jobs. That's what I do. Do odd jobs. That's my life.
So we've found out.
Yeah. A couple of guys
wanted some other friend's stall.
What's that?
Didn't hear somebody else's stall. Selling shields.
Oh, no, I only did that the one time. Really, I'm more of an adventurer like you guys. I go out and I kill things, and I collect things, and I do works for people. But yeah, there's this guy who wanted me to go look into the rift. There's apparently something he lost in there a long time ago. But have you guys heard?
Heard what?
There's this crazy infestation of what they think are zombies.
Where?
Yeah, they're up north.
You're going to have to be a little more specific than up north. There's a lot to know where it is.
Oh, well, last I heard, this is from a pretty good friend of mine, mind you. They're somewhere nearby Terminal 2.
Terminal 2? Is that somewhere here in the city?
No, it's like way up north. It's above the divide.
Oh, above the divide.
And when they call them zombies, do they just mean just dead
people? Are they
people?
Talking about the undead?
As far as I can tell, yeah, they're walking around and they try to chop off limbs and nobody can do anything about it.
That sounds fun.
That sounds dangerous. That needs to be put down immediately.
Oh, well, sorry I bothered you with it. I mean, it looks like you already have a job.
We'll get to it, don't worry.
It's not going to last that long.
Oh, well,
that's our hope, at least.
Yeah, if you guys get done with that, head up north. It's just, you know, follow the river. There's, you know, one of the forks leads up that way. Oh my god, Adobe Reader, stop crashing.
What's Adobe Reader?
What is this Adobe you speak of? Crashing?
Oh, it's this special material that you build houses out of.
Well, you know, they say don't build more than 2 stories tall.
Yes indeed. But yeah, if you guys want to head up there, I might be going up there myself just to see what's going on, maybe make a buck.
I'd be making more than a buck if I were out there.
Oh, you feel like people would pay you more for some reason?
Oh, I'd get something more out of it than just money, don't you worry.
That sounds well.
He gives you this really weird look, like
he wanted to say a boner.
It's a justice boner.
Zombies.
It's a boner for justice!
I'm a paladin of the Hotmut, and taking out the undead is quite my specialty.
Yeah, sure. And he sidles around the table as far away from you as he can get.
Octus just like sitting there going, can we go kill
I gotta be the now? Most awkward paladin ever. Like, oh god.
There's Mr. 18 charisma.
19.
Just because he's pretty cool, maybe he's smart.
Mine's 18. So yeah, if you guys...
My charisma comes from my faith.
You guys gonna be my in the city long?
My bad role.
not too long.
Nah, we'll be heading out tonight to try and handle this missing caravan business.
Aye, yeah. You need any help? I mean, if you can get me a little bit of gold out of it, I wouldn't mind coming with you.
Well, we're not getting any gold out of it, so we got none to share.
This is true.
Well,
there's right, things then. To kill.
We're always down for beating stuff up, so.
Yeah, well, I work for a higher calling.
The one that clinks when you rub totally. Them together.
Exactly. Oh, are you a faith man as well?
Yes, God. My church is a kind of a large building with a big old steel door inside of it.
You're part of the Ironwood too?
If I knew what that was, I'd say yes.
Okay, never mind.
All right.
Did I mess up my own name?
Octa pats him on the shoulder and says, "Well, let us buy you a drink and
Ironbark." Whoops.
Thanks for telling us the story of the North.
Oh, that's kind of you, but I've got to get back to my friends.
My own monastery's name.
I'll talk to you there later. Okay.
All right.
Good to see you again, sir.
Good luck on your journey.
Hey, thank you. And he heads back over and he sits back down and enters into hushed conversation with his friends again.
I'm worried he's going to come and ship
his name. Whoops. I messed up my
It's been a long time since you've been there, pal. It's understandable.
Yeah, it's been a few years.
Okay, so it's probably about, it's about evening time. Getting a bit later. The sun's starting to descend on the horizon. For those of you who can see out the windows.
The caravan palace, if you don't mind.
I'm down.
Yeah, I think it's about that time.
Let's do it.
Now all a bristle with weaponry.
Yeah, really. So you make your way over, now heavier for weaponry and lighter for gold. Back to the
Not
caravan palace.
Speaking of which,
you're just so lighter for gold, though.
I kind of want to sell the, at some point, I got to remember, I want to sell the gems that I have for the gold they're worth.
We'll do it later.
Okay.
Yeah.
I should have thought of this earlier, I'm sorry. Argus, can I have that cloak? I'd like to try it on. Replace mine for a little bit.
There you go.
So I'd like to wear the,
Cloak of the Manta Ray.
Cloak of the Manta Ray.
So, when did you do this?
I meant to do it after we had left the place. Thinking that I'll see if I wear it, if I can figure out what it does.
Okay, so you put it on.
Yeah.
You put it on and you feel some sort of faint magical aura from it as you wear it. You're not entirely sure what it does, but as you're sitting in the tavern having a drink, you sit there for a while. And you slowly start to realize, you know, what power you have on your shoulders. Go ahead and it's just the standard Cloak of the Manta Ray in the SRD, so you can go ahead and add that to your inventory.
Sweet, thank you.
So you realize that when you put the hood up, you are able to breathe underwater. And you also have swing speed.
Well, it wouldn't have worked with my horns anyway.
And swimming speed. That's so fantastic for somebody wearing heavy plate armor.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
This is true.
It's pretty clutch.
And at a certain point, you try to pull the hood up, and you realize that you can't breathe all of a sudden. And you feel it in your neck, and there's gills there.
Don't eat the gillyweed before you're in the lake.
How do scales and gills work at the same time?
Ian, what does a fish have?
But like right on their
scales and gills.
I know they have scales and gills, but it's not the same spot.
Well, it would work the same way.
It's magic. It has its own rules.
Yeah.
Right, stop arguing about this.
Please.
Are we at the Caravan Palace now?
You guys are at the Caravan Palace.
Sorry, thank you for that. I apologize.
So you're at
the Caravan
Palace.
I realized we kind of forgot about it.
You find your way into Jupiter's office. He's like, "All right, you guys ready to go? We got the caravan all set up. You ready to go?"
Yeah, let's go.
Let's do this.
All right, let's go.
One quick question for you there, Caravan Master. One quick question for you. Just so I know, before we, well, I'm still all here. If we do get attacked, do you want any of them buggers alive?
Yeah, man, I don't care. As long as the cargo makes it safe or you figure out where the rest of the cargo is, I don't care. Just do your job.
You just gave him free license to murderize.
Yeah, well,
I don't care, man. I just want my spot, okay?
I'm actually going to put a shirt on to be part of the disguise.
Yeah, Octus, like... So my question is he sending us with other people of his own men, or are we just going the 6 years?
Yeah, he does... lead you over to a caravan. There's three carts in a row, each with two horses, or actually two with two horses and one with just one horse. It's a bit smaller. They're laden with what appears to be full crates and barrels and the like, but for those of you who interact with them, you notice that they're a little bit lighter. It's like, yeah, I got this pretty much empty caravan ready to go. These horses are pretty much dead anyways. They're the oldest ones we got, so if we lose them, don't worry about it.
You're a dick.
It's okay.
Hey,
okay.
I'm trying to curb my losses, okay? I have a business to run.
Yeah, so go on.
So yeah, and these two guys, they're going to go with you. They're going to, be the cart drivers, and one of you is going to have to fill in as a cart driver, too.
Do anybody know how to drive a cart?
I'll volunteer to drive the last cart.
All right. So you guys, you ready to go? I got everything in the carts. Go ahead. See you later.
Let's go into the smaller one.
Have we all, like, paired off? I'd like to pair up with Octa for the drive.
I'll be with Arcus in the smaller one, and one of the crates in there, I guess.
Okay.
Right, that's how that works? That's what's happening?
There are some empty crates, so if you want to get inside or sit between them, there's some room there.
I'll get in one.
Okay. What order do we want to go in the carts? I'm driving the smaller one, am I, Brad?
If you want. That one's in between the two larger carts. They're all lined up right now. In order, ready for me.
Kyle!
Sorry.
Alright, I'll take the smaller cart in the middle, and I guess Kyle is in the back of that one.
Yep.
I'll take the last one.
Okay.
I'll hang back there with Valla.
Alright, so you guys get into your respective carts. The two drivers take the front and back wagons, and Argus is in the middle, adorned in his sorcerer's gear, but driving a cart nonetheless.
This is a robe.
Hey, he just looks like Gandalf. Now he's Gandalfing.
Yeah.
Violence. Against me. It's all good.
So you all start off. The lead cart takes off at a decent pace, and you make your way out into the night. The sun has gone down by this point, but each of the carts have lanterns on them, and the drivers have driven this route before, so they know exactly where they're going. So after a little while, possibly, a bit, maybe through the night's journey, some of you may have fallen asleep because you're driving straight through the night. And about halfway through the night, about midnight, you find yourself in a familiar copse of trees. The road is bordered on both sides by trees. And the lead car driver, keeps on pushing through. But as you pass through this area, you hear a clinking coming from the trees to the north.
Do I recognize it?
Octa kind of motions at Doc, like look outside, listen outside.
I'll take a peek outside to see if I can see anything.
All right, you look out into the expanse around you, and you see darkness. You see trees. Go ahead and make a perception check to see if you see anything.
I see him peek out and go.
I wait at Arcus.
Do I recognize the sound?
The sound does sound a little bit familiar. It actually sounds a little bit like Doc.
So clinky.
Like how I clink around in my armor.
Yeah, exactly.
But not as shiny, or else we'd see it.
But like that clink I heard the night we were attacked.
Yeah. So Doc, you look out into the dark. The lantern light extends a little bit beyond the carts. But otherwise, you don't really see anything in the trees. They're pretty densely put together.
If I look out with my night vision, will I see anything?
Yeah, you look out in the 60 feet radius you have from where you are. You don't really see, you don't see anything besides trees. You do see them clearly illuminated in your vision.
They're nice and black and white.
But you don't really see anything in the trees. Maybe a few shadows in the distance, but all you hear right now is that just a little bit of quiet clinking as if far in the distance.
So Vic will poke his head out to the driver of his back cart. And what he hopes is his loudest meek voice goes, any chance we'd be stopping for the night? It's my first run up this road, and I'm kind of nervous hauling off at night. It makes me kind of shaky and queasy. We plan on stopping here, or are we pushing through?"
He's like, "Yeah, man. We can stop here. Are you okay?"
"Yeah, just a little. I'm nervous about constantly moving in the dark. I lost my brother that way. It was bad. I'd like a chance just to kind of get out and stretch my legs and get some good air. I don't know. Maybe the other carts want to stop with us. It's probably dangerous to go alone."
Yeah, so you, he's like, "Yeah, man, okay, yeah." And you come to a stop, all the carts stop on the side of the road. You sort of set up a little bit of a camp.
I'm going to stay in the crate.
All right, let me, real quick. 1 second.
And while we're setting up the camp, Vic's going to make sure that his cloaks is, like, covering the handles of all of his various smashy, slashy, stabby items.
Okay.
And he's going to be walking between the three carts and doing his best to look like the inexperienced traders that he saw come and go from Forest Watch as a kid and as a young man.
Okay.
Really hoping to set up kind of that appearance that... He's a greenback. He doesn't really know what else going on, but kind of hoping. His plan is to hope to kind of lure whoever's been attacking caravans to come say hi.
Okay.
Ox is staying in the cart.
Same. Bella's I'm in a box.
All right. So as you wait, second. Let me just put these on the appropriate layer.
Map time.
All right. Let me put you on the map too. That's important.
Yeah. No. A little bit.
Yeah. What are you supposed to have?
Octa and Pow.
Woo.
And Argus. And Vic, who's looking about the carts on the outside.
I'm going to meditate while I'm in this cart.
Are we on the right layer?
I haven't sent you to the map yet.
No, I don't.
I'm going to make sure I'm...
Before you send it to us.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, you're right.
You know, just double-checking since that seems to be a recurring problem.
All right.
I'm meditating to see if I can, like, sense anything around as I sit in my crate.
Val is just extremely bored. Trying.
If I can get up.
She keeps poking her armor. Very impressed with how pointy it is.
Ain't this fancy?
Would you look at all this? Those horses look really fat.
Damn carts.
Horses.
Huh?
Don't shame the
horses.
I'm not shaming. Just saying. They look well fed.
Horse shaming.
All right.
I was the one that wanted to buy one.
So, let's see. Valla. Still don't see it. All right. So as you're looking about the carts, listening, you hear the clinking grow a little bit louder. And some of you start to notice that through the trees to the north, there's a few what appears to be armored individuals approaching.
Oh, man, they're monkeys.
Oh, no.
They're armored individuals. Disregard whatever look the token may have. Why on my description.
Armored individuals.
One of them appears to be sort of leading the way through the woods towards the front cart. The rest of them are just approaching the other carts.
Baby,
what do you do?
I sit in the cart. I don't know yet.
Baby.
Oh, well, baby.
So we can all see them.
I believe so, except for Pow, because Pow's still.
He's still asleep.
Wait, no, I'm in a crate.
Oh, you're in a crate.
Meditating around to see if I can use my senses to their utmost abilities.
Yeah, so you sort of stretch your consciousness outward as far as you can. Go ahead and make a perception check.
Because meditation does cool things. Perception?
Perception, yeah. All right, okay. So you're sitting in your crate, and you're kind of hunched forward because it's a little bit short, but you're okay because you contort easily. And you're trying to meditate on the surroundings, and all you can hear is the clinking and the general noises of the forest, and that's about it. Okay. You do hear other people start talking. The two guys who are driving the carts are starting to get kind of antsy, like, oh, what's what are those things?
Can I do a further perception to see if I can see what kind of figures they are, like any details?
Yeah, go ahead and roll that. All right, so you look at these armored individuals, and they appear to be wearing armor.
I'll get kind of the same look-see.
Okay, go
for it. I don't know if they'll do anything. No, I noticed so that they're armoring back sounds.
Right, Jack
looks out.
One more. Hey!
And he sees the reflection of the light on some shiny bits. And otherwise,
shiny bits.
Otherwise, he's focused on creating the illusion of greenhornness. Octa, in the meantime, uses her sharp, demonic eyes and tries to pierce the soul of the individual nearest her and realizes that there are no eyes beyond the helmet.
What?
At this point,
I look at talking like, dude, they don't have eyes.
As they're approaching, I'm going to either step up or do something to kind of make myself large and known, speak loudly, and say, we will put an end to your taking of these carts, or caravans. Back down, and no harm shall come to you.
They apparently hear your words, but they don't stop moving. They continue to proceed forward. And this one climbs on top of the cart, and tries to swipe
swing at it.
Oh. Or Octa, I'm sorry. This one comes out here to attack Arcus. So they start to appear as if to attack you. So go ahead and let's open up the timer here. Go ahead and roll initiative since you're aware of their presence.
Everybody?
Everybody who is aware of their immediate presence, so except for Pal. You can still roll initiative to see if you can hear stuff going on.
Dang it.
God damn it!
I was going to, you know, in the next next couple
Kyle,
minutes.
I don't know why we're cursed, but it needs to stop.
Yeah, I know.
Before they got to the carts, my idea was to, like, tap the box and be like, get ready, Pow.
Okay. So Pow's ready to strike if necessary. Is that everybody?
I am.
There's Valla. Okay.
Question, do I sense evil?
You do not sense evil.
Okay.
Construct! Metagaming!
I don't know that.
My bad. I guess it's constructs.
So, why does it say that he's first?
What?
What?
You rolled a 1 on their initiative. Man. God's sakes.
Well, barely. Okay, there we go.
I just hadn't sorted it, Valla. I'm sorry. Okay, so you see this armored individual approach you. There's one next to Vic, and there's one who's just climbed up the front of the cart to approach you.
Okay, well, right there. Being very freaked out, she, like, she cast something that I'm not sure she's cast yet, called a Thunder Wave.
Okay.
This is each creature in a field.
Thunder wave. So are you paralyzing people?
No.
No, it's not that kind of thunder wave.
Damn it, Paula, you're not a Pokemon.
So, Vic, go ahead and make a constitution saving throw.
Oh, wait, that affects Vic?
Yeah, every creature within the area.
Sorry, Vic.
I think you messed that up.
Yeah, that one.
Yeah, Brad, you failed.
No,
that.
I know. It's
a con save. Oh, for the love of Pete.
That's a bummer.
Sorry.
We take 11 and are pushed 10 feet.
Lord Almighty.
I didn't realize that it would affect you as well.
It's been a while since you used that spell, so you're a bit unfamiliar with its workings. Thankfully, you also did a decent amount of damage to the other two there.
Thunder damage. What happened to the cart?
What cart?
The cart she's standing on.
Is it not there?
No, it's there, but like...
No, with the giant cube of thunder irradiating out from her.
But you can see...
Does that mean the horses are affected as well, just
we can see the cart, but does that, like, hit the horses, and does it do thunder damage to the cart and all of the everything?
Yeah, that's true.
Secured objects.
How many hit points do elderly horses have?
They're gonna die!
So as you do your thunder wave, a cacophonous blast originates from you, smashing several of the empty crates below you, and the horses both collapse over, instantly dead.
Oh, damn!
The guy who is driving the cart, he actually gets blasted off of the front of the cart and slams into the next one, also dead.
Good lord!
Yeah.
I'm the worst bard ever. I'm sorry.
Doesn't that mean everything that was in the cart goes flying too? Because unsecured objects that are within the area?
Well, the cube, yeah, I mean some of them go flying, but for the most part they just get crushed underneath the blast from underneath her. She's sort of standing on top of it, so it's
they get pushed down.
Crushed downward. All right, Valla, do you want to do anything else?
I want to give someone some bardic inspiration. Any takers?
Probably Vic.
Yeah, Vic would love some inspiration.
Yeah, I'll give Vic some inspiration.
That's a 1d6.
Yep. That's right, yeah.
They get moved, though.
I'll heal you too, Vic. I'm sorry. Once my turn's back around.
10 feet. 10 feet. And Vic, you also get my friend.
Good. That actually kind of helps.
Yeah. All right. So, Vic, your turn. Unless, Valla, did you want to move anywhere?
No.
Okay.
All righty. So, Vic, having been blasted in the face with a cube of thunder, is going to scream out his rage. He's going to rip them all from under his cloak, get himself over there, And at the baddie immediately beneath him, he's going to take a swing. Raging advantage, raging reckless, maul attack to the face.
Okay.
And as he let's swing here and see what happens.
Nice.
Woo!
Crit cow, and that's 15 damage because it has 2 for the rage.
Okay. Yeah. So you you just managed to find a chink in his armor, so to speak, and you do a significant chunk of damage. Make sure there's no resistance. So yeah, he gets knocked forward just slightly from your blow, but he has not fallen currently.
All right, and. You guys notice, if you see Vic now, because I'm over here well within the lantern light, when he screams out his rage, you see, like, his arms get scales, like, shoot up from his wrists, his face stretches out, and he's got a nasty, just a maw of sharp, he looks like a little dragon, not a dragonborn, like a full-on dragon head.
Nice. I like it.
And, he screams out something to the effect of, come and get me, you smarmy bastards. And it's in Draconic, so.
Nice.
Yeah.
But they also understood it.
That's that. And that would be C.
Everyone who got that message understood what you said.
It didn't.
I don't see anything in the message.
You don't see anything?
No.
Oh yeah, I didn't send a message.
Oh.
But you didn't see a message come.
Okay.
Alright. So yeah, so Vic has his dragon moment. do you guys anybody need to go? It's 10 o'clock.
No, I can last through this real try to get it done quick.
Okay. All right, so Vic, your turn's over. Arcus, you see Vic have his little moment there. There's a armored individual right in front of you.
I am going to reach my hand out and cast Shocking Grasp on the man right in front of me. And I have advantage on it because he's wearing metal.
Okay.
Oh.
Boy.
So you reach forward and you take a hold of his arm, which feels to you like it's entirely clad in armor. You manage to give him a good grasp and shoot your electric arcanity into his arm, and you actually do notice that he sort of reels back a little bit, like it's doing a little bit more than perhaps it would have done to a normal person.
Very nice. And if I move, I'm guessing he's going to get an attack of opportunity.
You just made
yes,
it not be able to
take range of you right now.
He can't take reactions.
Oh, that's perfect. He can't take reactions.
Oh, because of your. That's right. Yeah.
Yeah.
You're right.
So I am going to hop down. I'm going to. Hop...
I forgot about that. Thank you for reminding me.
Perfect. Perfect. I'm gonna head over this way. Yep.
Okay.
That'll do it for me.
All right, Pow.
Hearing the lightning spring from the very close source, going to hop open the top and just punch him in the face.
All right.
It's a Pow in the box.
All right, so you you deliver a pretty mighty strike to him, knocking him back just slightly. He doesn't fall over, and he appears to not really like react like a normal person would in pain. He just sort of he takes the blow, and he just stands there ready for his next action.
And then I'm gonna punch him again.
All right. Whoa!
Oh,
cow.
Shit.
Critical hit. Hey, Ian, you might... I guess I should ask Brad, does that mean his crit damage would go up as well?
Yeah, that should be a d6 too, because that's your critical. You're right.
Yeah, that's more for you in your character sheet to switch as well.
Yeah, so you're welcome to... Actually, that didn't actually roll the dice, did it?
No.
Yeah, it looks like 0d0 plus 1d4. Oh, that's... Okay, yeah, it did roll the die. Never mind. So go ahead.
I just fixed the 1d6.
Okay. Still a pretty significant blow. Do you want to roll a d6 for that second roll?
Nah.
Okay.
Fine by me.
So that's... Alright, you hit him for another powerful strike with your new wooden knuckles and make contact with his armor. He reels a little bit, but just settles back into his position ready to fight.
Gonna all right. Stand and face him.
Alright. Doc, unless you want to move? You don't want to move?
Nope.
Just stand him. Okay, cool. Alright.
Going to approach closer to the one on our cart, and I'm gonna swing away. Seriously,
your balance isn't great on top of the cart, and you manage to swing, but you miss, unfortunately.
Okay. Octa, you didn't get hit, right?
I don't believe I did.
No, he just approached. They haven't taken their turn yet.
No, they rolled a one.
Yeah. So yeah, I'm good.
Even worse than us.
Yeah. So I'm good.
Okay. All right, Octa, your turn.
All right, I will, just for variety's sake, take a swing at that guy with my short sword.
Get him, Beelzebub.
Yeah, you swing out, but unfortunately his armor is just a little bit harder than you're used to. You make contact, but it doesn't really pierce at all. You don't think you've done anything to him.
Damn.
Wow.
I have one or two ideas of what that could be.
Good AC.
All I know is I don't like it.
I think his AC is like 18.
No, I think it has to do with... Yeah. I think it's slashing versus bludgeoning. Versus
bludgeoning again?
Yeah.
A lot of those eyeless type creatures have some form of reduction against specific types of damage. Which sucks, but on with the bumbling.
Well then, I'm going to just step over here. So we're kind of like flanking this guy on each side, and
okay.
I'll sheathe my sword, prepare my fists for fisticuffs next turn.
Okay.
Welcome to the club.
All right, so that's your turn. All right, now it's the armor's turn. The ones at the back here, this one's going to turn around and take a swipe at you, Vic. He's going to hit you, let's see, with two slams. He's going to slam his body into you. That's way too much. Good lord, that is not the dice roll that I am supposed to be rolling. So it rolled an 8d8, which definitely
oh, God. Was right.
What the hell?
Closer to its tail, I have some sort of magic.
That would kill all of us.
Yeah, that is not right. One second here.
I just watched a video of a guy skydive from like 20,000 feet and then landed a net. He didn't use a parachute at all.
Screw that noise.
I heard about that.
Trust in that net.
Yeah, 25,000 feet and he just fell into a net.
Oh, that's...
No
that's
parachute. Okay. It's terrifying.
Alright, let's try this again. Alright. Oh, come on. Why? Every freaking time, it just deletes the attack roll like it doesn't even matter. I swear.
Because it doesn't even matter. Nobody can hit it.
Alright. So he tries his first slam, sort of shoving his shoulder up against you, but unfortunately, you dodge out of the way. That one's not an issue for you. And the next one, is it 20? 20 doesn't hit you, right?
It is.
Okay. He hits you for 6 bludgeon damage.
3 damage?
Yes, 3 damage, because you are currently raging.
Raged!
Exactly. The other one here is going to make his way back up. Let's see if there's enough time. Okay. He's going to come over here to you, Valla. He's going to try to attack you. He hits you for one. A seven, I believe that misses. And an eight also misses. So this armor comes up on top of the carriage with you, and he tries to shove his shoulders into you real quick, but unfortunately he just dodges real quick, or you dodge real quick, I should say, and nothing hits you. All right, pal, this guy right in front of you, he's going to try to attack you. He's going to hit you for, oh my freaking god.
Did I die?
Natural one.
No. No. He gonna die.
And a 23 hits, definitely. There's no way that doesn't hit. For 3 bludgeoning damage.
Cool. Oh my god. Oh no.
Yeah. At this point, the one at the top, who some of you may think might be the leader or some such, he pulls out from his pouch a little crystal bell. And he jingles it, and you hear this strange melody come from the bell. It seems to fill your senses and lull you into a sort of sleepy state. All right, so
who's in a sleepy state?
None of you are asleep yet, but just give him. So let's see, the people closest to him.
And who's doing this? I'm sorry.
The armor right in front of you.
Okay, sorry. I was looking at my thaumaturgy cantrip.
All right. Currently, Octa, you fall asleep. And the cart driver, just next to him, you fall asleep. And this guy will come around here, and he's going to grab the cart driver and try to drag him off into the woods this way.
Am I asleep or no?
You're not asleep. So if you want to take an attack of opportunity, you're welcome.
Heck yeah.
All right, go for it.
I do not want to let him get away with this.
All right, you try to hit him, but unfortunately he's sort of a little bit below you, and your balance isn't quite right, and you miss him, and he continues on his way.
Damn it.
Are we fighting the Abhorson right now? Using bells, putting everyone to sleep, controlling armor?
You know I haven't read that, so I haven't.
I know, I'm just talking to myself.
Yeah, I'm not copying.
It's a good book!
All right, Val, it's your turn.
Baby agrees.
Well, I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of go into like a little bardic rage at the thing next to me. And
bardic rage.
So you
bitch better have my money. You start saying rap music.
Whispering evil nothings.
Evil nothings.
No. And as you say things to it, and you try to shock it with your strangeness and your arcanity, it doesn't react. It appears like none of it reaches.
Oh.
Okay. Well, I'm gonna try to go over to Vic then. I know he gets an attack of opportunity, right?
He would, yes.
And I'm gonna try to move away and go down here. To Vic.
Okay. He's going to try to swipe out of you with his gauntleted fist, but he rolls a natural one again, so fuck it.
Brad, your pain is our joy.
And I think I'm gonna try to throw some bardic inspiration to Doc.
Okay.
You do that. He'll catch it.
Accept.
Are you close enough?
Oh, I didn't realize there was a range on that. 60 feet.
Oh, Can you just give it to Akka?
Oh, no, I'm she's asleep. Asleep. Don't give it to me.
I'll give it to
Akka. I'll have inspired dreams. I'll wake up and be like, guys, I dreamt about these things. You put engines on them, they fly. It's ridiculous.
If you move to here instead, Valla, you can hit her within 60 feet, and you're still within range of me.
Okay, yeah, that's a good idea.
And it's the same every way else. Then you can hit have Doc get his stuff.
I'm gonna hear her here, too. Yeah.
I'm just curious how the inspiration thing works.
If you click the box, it kind of is just like an indicator of like, hey, you have inspiration.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So you get an inspiration, you moved, and that should be your turn. All right, Vic, you're up.
All right. Vic is feeling really super pissed. So he's going to swing again with the maul. He's going to go ahead and take that swing.
Shit, yeah, he is.
Don't you get, like, bonuses?
Now, for... How do we deal with crit damage in here? Is it... Reroll the... It's just the damage... The roll damage doubled? Or do we actually roll the damage... Like, a second set of rolls?
You roll the damage dice a second time.
Okay, and so I need to add that in still.
No, that one doesn't.
It does it for you.
No. It's not added on there.
That's the plus five.
Yeah, is that plus five? Oh, yeah, that's the plus five. Okay.
Yeah.
So, yeah, there's the plus three, plus two. Okay. Okay, cool. So, yeah.
Brutal criticals or something?
And then it's plus two on top of all of that because raging.
21. Okay. 21
so
damage.
So, 21 points of damage.
Yeah, you swing your axe, or your maul, actually. You do a mighty blow to this armor in front of you. And it actually collapses on the ground in front of you. And you notice there's not really any blood or anything coming out. It just sort of falls down, and there's a bunch of pieces of metal there sitting in front of you.
I was really disappointed.
I'll let Valla notice that I won't be, because I'm super pissed off and ragey.
All right.
You're probably especially mad. No blood.
Yeah, we can go with that. There's no bloody splash, so he's pissed. So then he is going to go ahead and move up here next to this one. No, I see Doc with the one over there.
That's running away.
Yeah. The one over here.
Oh, that's me.
Is still there, right?
Yeah.
Oh, Pow, not Doc, sorry. So he sees that Pow is being threatened by the little punk. So he's going to one, two, three, yeah, come up there, and Pow now gets to see his dragony snout in all its glory, and
David.
He's going to reach out and gnash at him.
Dragon bite.
Damn.
Sweet.
And he's gonna...
Oh, you still have your reckless attack, okay.
Oh yeah, because it's any strength-based attack, so.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah.
He's gotta be reckless, he's biting armor right now.
Yeah.
So I reach out.
You reach forward and you take a bite, and you rip a chunk off the armor, with your dragon teeth. And you see inside it's empty, and Pow, you see that as well, that the chunk he ripped away revealed an empty, inside. There's nobody piloting this armor, so to speak.
Overreaction.
It's...
Gasp.
So Pow says gasp. Vic, I'm assuming that's your whole turn?
Full metal.
Okay. Where are they?
It's out.
Alright, Arcus.
I will return momentarily.
Ding dong.
So, I'm gonna say that these guys have this guy handled. So, I'm going to turn up, look around, and see that this guy's trying to get away.
With one of the drivers.
30, get it next to him. We'll get like here. Yeah, there. And from there, I will use my breath attack on him.
Okay. Yeah.
Oh,
dang. Because apparently nothing is good against them.
So before you do that, you do realize that he is carrying somebody.
Oh, well, I was hoping he was, like, dragging him, and he was, like, on the ground in front of him.
Yeah, but he's still, like, because he's holding him, he's in range of your breath weapon. Would you still have used it in that case?
Yeah, I didn't get that option.
That's true.
Vic.
Yeah.
I forgot to give you that option, so I'm trying to fix myself in the future.
crap. And I'm guessing if I ran up to him and used Shocking Grasp, it would still affect him?
No. Because you would just be affecting the one creature. That spell, like, the energy wouldn't have traveled through.
Okay.
Know. It's not as powerful as a breath weapon, so.
Then I'll do that instead. I think I was close enough to, yeah. I'll run up to him.
Alright.
And Shocking Grasp!
Alright, yeah, you managed to get your hand on him. Do a significant amount. You can see him reeling back a little bit, but he definitely isn't done moving.
Then I think that's it, because, yeah, I definitely used all my movement to get up to him.
Yeah. Okay. Yep. Pow. You got a guy in front of you who's empty.
Punch him again.
All right. You strike out, hitting him right in the center of the torso, and as you do, the entire armor collapses around the empty frame that was holding it.
No. All right. Turn around and run to this guy.
Okay. So you hop across the horses, right in front of that guy.
Use a key point, flurry of blows, to punch him in the face twice.
Alright.
So did you get more than two?
I get an extra attack. I can make two unarmed strikes as a bonus action.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so as you jump across, he doesn't appear to expect you. He receives the first blow pretty significantly. Dealing a decent amount of damage to him. But the other one manages to miss just slightly. He dodges it to the side.
I mean, this is my second attack now.
Oh, what was the second one here, then?
That was the first attack for this guy.
Oh, well then...
What?
I'm looking
first,
at
the first oh, attack
yeah.
under my name.
Oh, yeah, yeah, the 21.
Was for the top guy. The
11 didn't hit.
I'm yeah, assuming. So...
11 doesn't hit this guy.
Same situation. Reverse that. Sorry, I was looking at the first strike because I thought you had rolled it already and I just...
No. I just rolled the one.
So, you did, what was that? Okay. Alright, so yeah, you see him reel back a little bit, but he's not falling down yet. Alright, anything else you want to do? You have any more? I think you're out of movement, right?
I only used 25.
Oh, okay.
I could move more if I wanted to, but I'm not gonna.
Alright. Doc, you're up.
I get way too much
movement. I'm gonna... run up to there. I have a couple of options. Smack, I believe. Yeah, I'm going to, not wanting to have him go any further, feeling a new energy that I've not felt before, and cast... Channel Divinity.
Okay.
So essentially, causing spectral vines to spring up and reach to the creature within 10 feet of me, must succeed on a strength or dexterity saving throw of its choice. If it fails, it's restrained.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It works. So he's now...
Spectral vines have reached up from out of the ground and have held him in place.
Yeah, so he's not moving anymore right now.
Brandon's not happy.
Why do my monsters not work? They just don't do what they're supposed to do. Come on, guys. Better monsters.
And then I'm going to cast... Just because I a little worried about him being so close. I'm going to cast Shield of Faith onto Arcus, okay. Giving him a plus 2 to AC.
Can you do Channel Divinity as a bonus?
No, Channel Divinity is my major. The spell is a bonus.
Oh, is it? Oh, okay, I see that. You're right. Okay, cool. So, yeah, so Arcus, you feel a glow about you, and you feel a little bit stronger. Your limbs have limbered up slightly, so you can dodge things a bit easier now.
Thanks, man.
I thought it was a shimmering field.
You're a shimmering field.
Okay.
Because you illuminate me, Ian.
Thanks.
Huh? Get it? Because he reminds me of stuff a lot.
You have that for up to 10 minutes, so that'll definitely last this battle and longer.
All right, so anything else you want to do?
Nope, that'll be my turn.
All right, Octa, you're up.
I'm asleep.
You are asleep. And that's it. That's all you can do. All right.
Yeah. Does he get any sort of saving throw to wake up?
Oh. Thanks, no, people, for waking me up. Yeah, Octa snores a little bit and just flips over, pulling her cloak tighter about herself.
Yeah. Doc, if you had taken an action to try to wake her, or a bonus action to try to wake her up, she would have been, but...
I was more concerned making sure he didn't get away. All right.
Yeah, I think that was.
No one's. You're not in any immediate danger of being asleep. I know that means you're not helping us, but you're also not in any immediate danger.
Not that he's holding it.
Okay. So this. Your channel divinity, does it have like a save to break free of the vines?
While restrained, the creature repeats the saving throw at the end of each of its turns.
Okay. Well, it's gonna let go of the guy in front of it. It's dragging and take a swipe at each of you guys. No. This one's for Doc. What's that?
Did it break free?
It didn't break free because it's not the end of it.
Does the restraint just stop forward motion, or is it like a grapple where they can't do anything?
It's just a stop motion. Oh, okay. They cool. can't move any.
Go ahead.
I forgot to apply disadvantage. So let's make sure this isn't this. Okay, good. Does a 17 hit?
It does not.
Okay. So he swipes at you, unfortunately unable to hit. And at Arcus, 11. I don't believe that hits.
Nope.
That's right.
What's your new AC?
His
My
strength.
New AC is 18.
Oh, nice.
My normal is 16.
Sweet.
Why do you jump up so much?
Shield of Faith?
The Shield of Faith.
Oh, Shield of Faith, that's right. I was gonna say, like, you didn't get any armor or anything.
No.
Yeah, okay. That makes sense. All right, so cool. All right, so he's done. This guy on top of the cart is going to try to power you into strike out against him.
Oh, yeah. I love to punch things.
All right, so you swing out at him, but unfortunately he moves too fast for you, and he gets out of your range.
Too fast for me. Baloney.
He is he's officially in the force now. Right, and everyone else is collapsed into a pile of nothing. So that's cool. All right, Valla.
I'm gonna run up here and heal Vic precisely.
Okay.
So that's 5 points back. You said?
Ooh.
Hot damn. That looks wild.
And...
Oh, okay.
What the heck is happening with
that? Is there anybody that's like, why do you have guys up there that needs Bardic Inspiration that doesn't have it already?
Far away. I mean, you see Pow up on the cart you just came from. You see Octa sleeping. Doc and Arcus are both engaged with one of the armors.
I'm gonna run over to Octa after that. Well, no, I don't think I have the movement for that.
Yeah, we can at least start your way over there.
Yeah.
By the way, Doc, I think we should try and keep this guy alive and see if he can speak, one, and if he can tell us anything.
I guess we can sort of try. I don't think Doc's going to... I don't think Doc actually is going to react very well to just a creature of suit. Seems unnatural to him.
Yeah. I think I'm up before you, so...
It's fine.
I'm going to probably spend my time trying to talk to it.
So, Valla, are you doing anything else? Any attacks or anything? Actions?
If I gave Octa Bardic Inspiration, would that wake her up?
since you're within earshot, if you want to try to like yell out for her to wake up, if you do it well enough, we'll see if she wakes up. But otherwise,
Octa, get your ass up off of that cart! This is no time for sleeping and dreaming, the dreaming dynamic dream. Light the fire under that ass.
All right, go ahead and make a performance check.
How loud can you be?
Yeah, unfortunately, Octa does not wake up.
Damn.
It seems like a deep, magical sleep.
Octa hugs one of the crates nearby. Like, yes, no crate.
All right, Vic. The guy in front of you just collapsed under Paz's fists, and the other guy there is occupied by Doc and Arcus.
I can see the guy that's off over there, just at the edge of the lamplight, right?
I believe so. Yes, you just see him escaping into the woods.
Okay, so now the way that dash works,
it consumes your action, and you can move twice your movement speed.
Okay. Let me just check something here real quick, because I think it's at a higher level that I get it, but I'll let it get fast movement. Yeah, okay. Okay, so, but I can still then take a bonus action, even yes. with using the dash, right?
Yeah, you can.
So, move speed of 30, means 25 there. 23 gives me 45 feet, which is two moves. So I will get up there.
Okay.
And I'll jump him.
All right.
And I'm going to use my inspiration.
Okay.
That would be a 20.
Yeah, so
for...
So as you run across through the trees, you remember Vala's encouraging words, and you manage to sink your teeth around one of his shoulder plates and do a pretty decent amount of damage. He doesn't fall before you, but he does look like he's missing quite a bit of his armor. Maybe he'll fall down soon, in your opinion.
And do I still have like a chunk of his armor in my mouth?
If you didn't drop it, yeah.
Sure, I'll keep it in my mouth.
All right.
Chewing out some metal.
Arcus, what are you going to do?
I'm going to speak to this thing and say, where do you come from? Where do you bring these the carts that you've been stealing? Let's see if it responds.
You try talking to it, but it just sort of stays, you know, it doesn't really react to you at all.
Aha. Can that be my bonus action so I can still do something?
yeah, that's your bonus.
In that case, another shocking grasp.
All right.
He's all metal and stuff.
Shocking grasp all day, every day.
Yeah.
That's a pretty decent cantrip. All right. Are you supposed to be at advantage?
Yes, because he's metal.
Oh, that's right. Okay, cool. So yeah, you reach forward and you do a pretty decent chunk to him. He sort of reels like he did before, the same sort of reaction you've seen. This one did a little bit more damage, but he's still not down.
And then I'm going to, since he can't take reactions, I'm just going to step over this way. In case he does try to flee, if he breaks out, I'm kind of in his way. Maybe I could get an attack on him or something.
Okay.
Yeah, there. And that'll do it for me.
All right. Pow.
I'm going to first just call over to Valla. Just to make sure someone not raging and paying attention here is Valla! I'm going to be chasing this one. I'll leave any trail I can.
Okay, I'm going to try to wake up Akda.
Got it. And then I'm going to run into this tree. Over to this spot here.
Okay.
And stealth there. Trying to whisper to Vic on the way. Vic, let this one go. If he can even understand me.
Good luck.
Just to make it fun, throw a performance check.
Yeah. See if you break through his,
Oh!
That shouldn't be advantaged. That shouldn't be advantaged, sorry.
So what
it was really the same number.
Oh, the exact same number, so... yes, I hear him... I hear him speak. Is what I'm going to go with.
I hear words.
All right.
My perception is more than adequate to hear his words.
Mm. Pal, you notice there's a little bit of maybe recognition in the rage on Vic's face.
Got it.
You feel sure that he got your message. Go ahead and make a stealth check to see if you can hide. Moving as fast as you did, it's going to be harder for you.
I was just regular movement.
Yeah, but I mean, in the circumstances, you don't have a hide action self.
I can use a key point to hide as my bonus. I didn't even use my action, though.
Yeah.
Well, you had to dash, okay. Didn't you?
No, I don't. My movement speed is 40.
Yeah. All right.
Didn't
so,
you? It looks like you moved more than that, but okay.
I just moved 40.
So you're there. You can't tell if he can see you or not. All right. Doc, your turn.
Gonna swing my hammer.
Sure thing, John Henry.
Swing my hammer right around.
And because I've connected, I'm going to also make it a divine smite.
Okay. Wow.
So 9 bludgeoning plus 10 radiant.
Okay. Okay, cool. So you do a pretty big chunk to him. You see him reel back a little bit, but he's not quite down yet. He's still... you see the vines at his feet have weakened a little bit, perhaps. But he's still standing up fine.
Mm-hmm.
So, bonus or movement?
No. He's very satisfied with that hit.
Okay. Akda, you can't do anything.
Poor Akda.
Poor Akda.
This is a great battle, guys. You guys are doing awesome.
If only someone were to come over and wake you up. But, you know, all the dream.
Shit, man, quit reminding me. It ain't like I can come over and wake myself up. I summoned Dane to this game to wake me up.
Roll a 1d100. The universe, man.
Roll a what?
Roll a 1d100.
A 1? Oh, God. I'm doing it just because I haven't done anything in so long.
She just left
1d100, right?
Yeah.
Nice. There's a 5% chance of it.
I rolled a 5 out of a 5!
fucking 100!
So you, in your dreams, imagine this fox-like elf person who you don't even know, and you imagine her, and you're like, oh, she's pretty, and then you just...
You keep going in your dream.
And there's a gnome next to her.
Yeah. There's this gnome chilling. Gnome.
All right, just, so this guy here, he's gonna run away.
Wave to you on the way.
As fast as off into the woods. Vic, are you gonna make an attack of opportunity?
Yeah.
Okay.
Go ahead. Where is that? And this is at a regular swing with his. How did I go? There it is.
Yeah. So you knock out a bit of the armor on his back, but the empty shell runs away from you, manages to escape. So he's now deep into the woods. The other one next to Doc, he's going to try to run away as well. Doc, you're welcome to try to stop him.
I will. Did he? Oh, so he finally broke free of the vines.
Yes, he did it. Yeah.
Oh, god damn it!
Damn.
Was he close enough to me, or no? Did he?
Let's see here.
Whack him with your stick.
Yeah, no, he's just out of your range, unfortunately.
Darn, I tried. I should have just stood there.
Yeah, all really. Right.
So they both run off into the dark of the woods. How combat has sort of ended at this point, so Pow, you're welcome to pursue them if you like.
I can't see very well. Would I still be able to do it?
You would have to have some sort of light source, unfortunately.
Mm.
Unless you navigated by hearing, but that's going to be a very difficult perception check for you.
Nah, I'm going to start the follow and then be like, wait a second. Bit too dark for this.
All right. So you guys, you come back to the carts. You notice that one of the guys who came with you is dead. Maybe by one of the armor's hands. You're hoping. The other guy is over by Doc. He's asleep right now. As is Octa still for just a short while. So if you want to try to wake them up.
I'm gonna leave this one for Arcus, and I'm gonna head back and go wake Octa up.
Okay. And as Vic gets back into the clearing and his rage drops, his face slowly starts coming back to human, with the exception of the stuff he had earlier, the slight scaled guys, dragon slits, and whatnot.
Yep.
Arcus is gonna wake the guy up and start moving him back over towards the cart.
There's nobody right there with you. Are you guys talking about the guy who is taking the... Who are you dragging, Arcus?
There was a guy.
He was our driver.
Who was being dragged away.
Our driver, okay.
Yep.
I'm going to look out into the distance. Being like, God damn it.
So your assailants have escaped into the woods, and it is currently, about midnight. The moon is high in the sky. And that's where we're going to end our session.
Damn.
Ooh. Ooh. Oh, boy.
Glad I slept through that.
We got some hunting to do.
That was
fun.
Yeah, we do.
Too bad none of us is a ranger.
Yeah, right?
Yeah. So, for those of you playing the home game, Vic decided to go Path of the Totem Warrior as a barbarian. And because Brad rocks, given all of our exposure to dragons and lizard-type folk, and... because of Doc's rousing, fervored devotion to Bahamut, he actually chose to trod the path of the dragon totem, which is not in the book. So he, at this level, when he rages, he gains a 1d10 bite attack.
Nice.
So,
is that a homebrew thing? Is that?
Yeah, he and I worked it up because it's. The SRD is there's bear, wolf, and eagle.
That's not enough.
And we're like, dragon seems like it would fit pretty well with everything that I've encountered so far, and kind of what do you do? And then the fact that we were drinking the Dragonfire whiskey just played really nicely into it. So
I like it.
So for next week, make sure that any special stage you have to add for your character. I think a lot of you have. I mean, like Chris picked the path of the Totem Warrior. You might need to pick an archetype or a monastery. You know, how you already know what you're doing there.
Yep. I know what I'm doing.
You know, your various things. You need to make sure you put those abilities into your sheet, because those don't get added automatically since they're a choice.
Yeah.
And if you need help doing that, let me know. And also, if you have any new spells, make sure you add those as well, as part of your leveling.
Yep, I gotta spend some time and figure all that stuff out.
Yeah.
Quick question before we all leave.
Go ahead.
Oh, sorry.
Go ahead.
What are we thinking about for next week? Because I'm going to be at Brad's for probably most of the day Saturday, coming home at some point on Saturday. I don't know if Sunday will just end up working better for us next week, maybe.
I don't have any plans at the moment.
Yeah, not at the moment. Work's going to be picking up fairly soon, so the weekends might have to do a bit of juggling, but I think it's always busy time.
And there's no real particular, other than, you know, what we had tonight with me. There'll be times when you have a baby watching and times that you don't, so.
Baby!
Granted, most
That's
of the,
okay, that's just when you teach her the ways of the barbarian of the
time. Most of the time she sat around like this.
Aww!
Which one is this?
Cute.
This is Leah. Rachel's got Gwen back there trying to get her changed, so.
Adorable. How do you tell? What is your defining difference?
Leah's got her eyes are a little closer together, and her nose like turns up at the end, and she's got like these little elf ears.
Nice.
I don't know if you can see them overly well here.
I'd have to make everything large.
Yeah, Gwen. Yeah, it's... Hi, Leah. Whoa, she turned her head.
She's like, don't show me off like I'm a troop.
But her ears come to a little point. Gwen's are like all round, and Gwen's nose turns down at the end of it, and she's just like chubbier overall. She's just baby. So,
nice. Yeah.
So I know I've told Brad, Peter and Ian, you cannot say a word to Mother. We will tell her at some point, but
yes, do not tell Mother.
No, do not tell Mother. Weird. I'm pretty sure that Arrow is pregnant.
Oh, good lord.
Yeah, apparently yeah. Pixel's a guy.
Oh.
Oh.
WTF. I just,
yeah, exactly.
That's just, wow.
Did you ever, like, get it sexed by somebody, or did you just assume this whole time?
Well, yeah, we pretty much assumed we did... Yeah, we pretty
much.
Doesn't
Pixel have balls? I mean, you can usually see balls on cats.
Don't they have like people you can take them to and go, hey, this one's got a dick?
Well, I mean, outside of actually going fishing for those things with cats, you can see their junk.
Yeah. Okay. I don't
usually.
Know.
Usually,
way, you guys have fun with that.
Yeah.
How do you know she's pregnant?
Because her like female nipples are starting to perk up. And she's, like, oddly rounded larger than she has been in past weeks.
You should probably
like,
get
you can, like,
that,
feel
dude.
It. Yeah, I
you
know.
You said that to her, right? Because girls are really sensitive about that.
No. I mean, she can hear what I'm saying, but she's not paying attention, so.
And Rachel says, remember to spay and neuter your pets. A la Bob Barker.
Yeah.
Bob Barker.
Yeah.
A la Bob Barker.
I've tried, but money.
God, we're going to go... We're going to go get these little ones wrapped for bed, so.
Hey, well, good night, everybody.
If you ever end up spending more time here, you can actually take them to someplace here called Animal Friends, and they'll spay and neuter your cat for, like, a much reduced rate. Like, if you, they don't even, like, verify how much you make, but if you make, like, under $45,000, they'll do it for, like, $40.
Oh, alrighty. Yeah. It'd be a little bit Animal interesting to bring them out there, but.
Yeah, they do. That's where I got Freya. Spade, actually.
Yeah.